Hello and welcome everyone to Cybercast episode 142, the Transformer podcast show. Today we are going to be taking a look at a lot of Transformers and some action figures as well, but we do have our guest Pete Sinclair with us from Botcon and Transformers Collectors Club. But before we get into that, a couple of people, go ahead and shout your stuff out. Dakota, where can people find you, man?
You can find me everywhere at PrimalSabbath.
And Jaim, where can people find you, man?
You can find me on Twitter, YouTube, VictorySaber77, on Facebook, TheVictorySaber77. We have another show at 10:30 p.m. Central Standard Time on my YouTube channel. It's Plastic Fanatics. It's the Late Night Aftercast. Take a look at that. Check it out. If you want to be on, we have a live link on my Facebook page. It's open to anyone. Tonight, we're going to be talking about Beast Wars, but we're also going to be talking about some other toy lines and other Transformers subject stuff. But check that out.
And you got Collection Spotlight announcement.
And Collection Spotlight, we don't have anything this week, but if you guys want to have your collection spotlighted, 10 to 20 pictures, send them to Josh at g1xrun@gmail.com. No collections too small or big. It does not have to be centered around Transformers. You know, we collect a lot of things, Star Wars, figure arts, the whole thing. So just send in your pics. We'll spotlight you on the next show.
All right, and you can find me, g1xrun, on Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and my Facebook page is theg1xrun. And now for our guest, I don't want to say special guest, but you're like kind of a member, but you show up once a month, is what it seems.
I'm no longer special, and that hurts.
Well, now you're kind of a reoccurring guest. You show up like maybe once every month or two. So anyways, Pete, where can we find you, man?
6 months there, that's it. I'm off. I'm going to go on that other one. I guess I do know the spiel. Where you can find me at?
Yes. Right. Where can people find you?
You can find us at botcon.com, transformersclub.com. We got Facebook page. You can find Botcon Transformers Club on there. Twitter at botcon, at the TF Club, at the underscore TF underscore Club. And then for Joe, we do all the Joe stuff too. So if you cross over, GI Joe Con, the G.I. Joe Club, so on and so forth. We're everywhere. We try to be everywhere, most everywhere.
All right,
and
so I guess
you can find me here all the time, too, like every week. Just dial me up. Pete, come on! All right.
I guess kind of an intro. Why don't you tell us a little bit about Botcon for those that don't know. I think most do if they're watching this show, but you might just kind of give a little short introduction to that, but also talk about some of the packages that are still available, because you got some things that you just announced. So what's still available out there for people that haven't signed up yet?
So Botcon, for anyone that doesn't know, which I think there might be one person there, is the longest-running Transformers convention, started in 1994 by John Carl Hartman. I've been involved in one way or another since 97, with breaks here and there, longer breaks, I guess. Came on full-time back in 2008. Well, started working in an advisory role in 2005. Came on full-time in 2008. As far as what we do Transformer convention. Guests, toys, special events. This year, we've got, I think, a huge event. We've got, on Friday night, the Stan Bush and the Vince DiCola concert at 4th and Live in downtown Louisville. We've got the Beast Wars 20th anniversary celebration with David Kay, Venus Turzo, and Scott McNeil. David will just be there Friday, but Scott and Venus will be there all weekend. We've got panels, seminars. We've got the casino night dinner on Saturday night. Now, this is all if you're part of the Primus package, except for the concert that is open to the public. And finally, in addition to all that other stuff, and there's more, cosplay contest outside of the dinner time, so that's open to the general public. But the big thing that we just announced this week is we got the voice of Hot Rod from Transformers, the movie 1986, also star of The Breakfast Club and St. Elmo's Fire, and he has a recurring role on that TV show Empire. He's currently filming The Billionaire's Boys Club. Mr. Judd Nelson is coming out. We've been working on that for about 2 months. Things don't happen overnight, so that was kind of our big thing we wanted to do. I want to make sure it could happen. He's very excited to come out. He's very aware of the Transformers fandom. talking to the agent. They you know, people come up to him about the Transformers out in L.A. So he's excited to come out. It's gonna be a great time. We did this last year with Frank Welker. We were the first convention to bring you Frank Welker. We were the first convention to bring you Weird Al and Tyrese Gibson, and now we're gonna bring you Judd Nelson. So there it is. We've got the VIP package. That is an addition to now the Dave Kay, Venus Turzo, and Scott McNeil are included in your Primus package. But the Judd Nelson, we have a VIP pass, which gets you an autograph, a professional photograph, not just at the table, you know, the quick iPhone picture. You know, we got a professional photograph, a print, and an exclusive pin. And we've got some more stuff that's a little bit more for this year, too. Just haven't really announced that. But that's what your base VIP package with Judd Nelson gets you. So there it is.
What the second part of that?
And that is $129. That the cost of that is last year's Frank Welker was $200. This year we were able to get it considerably down. It's at $129. So that you can add on to, and that can be added to all four packages: your Primus, your Golden Ticket Primus, your Mini-Con, and your Vertical.
Okay. The kind of add on to that. What packages are still available? How many Primus you think? On Golden Ticket.
Last year, I think we sold, numbers were kind of down. We only sold 56 golden tickets of 100. We upped it to 110 this year, and we are close to selling out. I think we're only, last I checked, we were at 101, but I know we had one other person that was calling to upgrade, and then someone contacted me online wanting to upgrade, so I don't know if we're sold out now or not. We're probably close. I think as we get to those last 2 weeks, if we're not sold out yet, we will be. Primus is doing great. Mini-Con is doing great. Protoforms are even up. So we've had a lot of the numbers are looking really good for this year. Definitely stronger than last year. Last year was a little bit of wasn't a slow year, but it was just seemed like coming back to the Midwest, people were like, oh, you haven't been here for a while. And I think everybody, now that we were back there and everybody's glad to see us back here, the numbers are definitely up for this year. So.
And Golden Ticket attendees get a separate figure, correct?
Yeah, that's something new. I'm sure that probably helps with the numbers a little bit. But, you know, in this modern day of Transformers where it's obviously impossible to have everything, you know, there's exclusives everywhere. We thought we wanted to do something that was definitely more of a compliment, but I don't think really is something – it's something that's very cool. And it is a – I think I've already said it's a version – of the Troop Builder, excuse me. So it's new colors, but it is not like, I don't want to downplay it. It's a cool thing, but it's not like we're giving you a free Voyager with a new head sculpt or something, is what I'm trying to say. You know, it's something that I think is a definite added bonus to that package, but, you know, we wanted to make sure it wasn't something where people were like, you know, screaming that we were giving away, you know, a lucky draw figure or something like that. That's, you know, gold and, you know, it's whatever. So it's something I think and of course that's not the only thing you get with the Golden Ticket. With the Golden Ticket, you get the Friday night reception, which I have also announced that Judd Nelson will be at that. Frank wasn't able to be there for that last year, but we've got Judd will be there. So the 110 people, he'll be there socializing and hanging out with the Golden Ticket peeps on Friday. Gets you 3 times the quantity on souvenirs. VIP seating for all the panels, which includes the first 3 rows for the Judd Nelson. We'll do it like we did with Frank last year. We'll do a moderated panel again. So, and there's other stuff. I'm just blanking. Oh, there's an exclusive VIP print. Or golden, not VIP, I should just confuse the terms here. Exclusive Golden Ticket print, which will be signed by Judd, David, Venus, and Scott. So, an exclusive print that you can only get for the Golden Ticket. So lots of cool little extra perks. You get to pick up your packages on Wednesday night. Don't have to wait in the lines. So there's advantages to it for sure.
I have a question about the Golden Ticket pin. Is it going to be like it was last year, a totally separate pin, or is it just going to be a gold version of – okay, cool.
It's a completely different pin, and it is pretty wonky. But it totally plays into the Beast. It totally plays into the Beast Wars 20th anniversary. But it's it made perfect sense to me, so I pushed for it. So
It's a picture of Dakota. His mug.
I said I would push for it. I didn't say I was bribed into doing it.
He may or may not have been bribed into doing it.
Blackmail would be the better word.
All right, Dakota, you want to get the next?
Yes. Would you talk about the 2016 comic, Dawn of the Predacus? We know you shared some stuff on Twitter, and it had me pretty excited.
This is going to be another long-winded answer. I'm sorry. I'll make up for it in other answers and keep it shorter. So the Dawn of the Predacus, we approached IDW. This is something I've wanted to do for a while. Just the timing was never right. We approached IDW last year. Said, hey, look, you know, we'd like to do more of a collaboration. Want to work with you more here. You know, we got the set. You know, can we do a one-shot? You know, we've got these great toys, these great characters. We'd like to, you know, see what you all could do with them. You know, so kind of went back and forth, kind of figured it out, and they were open to it. And they said, sure, we'll do it. And I said, oh, that's awesome. I was excited. I'm like, all right, cool. Because, you know, sometimes it's hard to kind of make those things happen. But they were up for it. I was like, awesome. So they pretty much took control of it. I provided them the toys. Said, here's the toys. Here's the characters. Whatever. You know, you guys do the, you do the story if you want. And I said, you know, I kind of had an idea, but, you know, we kind of want to do the creative thing. I said, that's fine. Go for it. We've got plenty of universes to play into. So they did it. I've seen it. I've seen it's being wrapped up. Corin Howe, and I hope I pronounced her first name right, and KP Bove, John Paul Bove, he wrote it, and she did all the lines, and then he's also doing the colors on it, because he also does colors. What else to talk about? The Beast Wars story. What has he said online? It takes place in the last 48 hours of the Great War. I know he also posted that... Sorry, I have to look off camera, because I have to... That's why I don't sometimes look forward. I'm trying to make sure I remember everything that was written or what he said, make sure I'm not saying anything out of turn. Last 48 hours of the Great War, it was tied into Beast Wars proper. It's loosely tied. I mean, it is tied into IDW continuity. And I think, you know, and this was something I was thinking about earlier. And actually, I talked to him at length about this last night. Jesse and me were all chatting, and I wanted to kind of get his idea. You know, I mean, Beast Wars is kind of a tricky property because everybody is very much loyal to the series. And I know people don't like to mess with that. It's always been kind of like that one thing that was pure and everything. Unlike G1, which had four different...
No, keep going. Keep going.
I'm not dogging on it, but what I'm saying is that in 84 you had a comic startup and you had a cartoon startup. So from the very beginning you already had two different G1 continuities. And then the cartoon had all kinds of continuity issues within that continuity as far as the multiple Constructicon origins and so on and so forth. And, you know, so there was always kind of this, you know, things that kind of got just missed in G1. Whereas Beast Wars was just very pure, and I'm not trying to say anything disparaging about that. I'm just saying it was an 80s cartoon, and that's what it was, and that's fine. 90s was just a completely different beast, no pun intended, and it was, everything was smooth, worked out perfectly, it was very smooth, the story flowed great, it all connected, continuity was there, everything. So I think it's held up as this kind of, as it should. It's put on this, on the shelf, and that's fine. However, it has been 20 years since Beast Wars. So it gets kind of tricky as to what you can do to add on to that. Either you just completely leave it alone, or you add on to it. And in 2006, we added Dawn of Futures Past. And, you know, I've said before publicly, I said if I could go back and do it over again, maybe the one thing I would do is maybe not do that with Airazor. So I was talking to Jesse about having her be a protoform beforehand. And when I was talking to Jesse, who's does a lot of our writing, does a lot of everything. He's a jack of all trades. But and he kind of had a different view on it, and I saw that view, and that kind of made me even rethink my position on whether or not we should have had her or not. And I'm thinking, well, maybe I kind of am okay with fact that we brought Air Razor in. So my point to all this is that it started with, well, 3H started, let's be honest. I mean, 3H added on to the mythos. And then you've got us with Dawn of Futures Past. And then, you know, and this is, of course, not even counting all the stuff that happened in Japan. But you've got, I'm just talking about people that kind of came after that the properties were, it was rested or, you know, done or whatever. And then you've got what IDW did. And we've done some more stuff. We've done, like, this Wings of Honor thing, where the Wings of Honor universe is very much like the G1 cartoon, and it ties into the start of Beast Wars. And it's safe to say that the way that Beast Wars was written, it could tie into both the G1 cartoon and the comic. Maybe it was tied into some crazy mix of the two, and they did, you know, I know there's different, I know they've gone on record, and I don't know it offhand. You know, and I think, you know, and I am just kind of going on a diatribe here, or a tangent, I should say. The people could say that in the cartoon, that the cartoon maybe had some of the elements from the comic, which means the cartoon could solely tie into Beast Wars, and that the comic ended up with some elements from the cartoon as far as, like, Galvatron killing Starscream. Maybe that happened after the end of G2. That could lead into the whole swarm aspect. My point to all of this is that none of this takes away from Beast Wars. Beast Wars is kind of like this intersecting point. It's kind of like this, you know, kind of the end point. And you got all these other continuities that kind of feed into it, and then it hits it, and then they can all kind of split back out. My point is that Beast Wars can have many different origins at this point. And 10 years from now, who knows? Someone else is going to have another story, and that's great. So none of what we do, you know, I guess I'm just trying to assure people, none of what we do has anything to do as far as changing the Beast Wars story. We're just adding a different, and I'm talking solely from our I guess I'm not answering your question directly. I'm talking more about what we do. Beast Wars has, I guess, a lot of potential origins, is what I'm trying to say. What the origin of some characters in one continuity for, like, Wings might be something completely different from that for something else. So my point to all this is I want people not to have any expectations when they read this story. I want them to, from what I've seen of it, I mean, I've read the script and I've seen, you know, the art. This is a very cool story, but you kind of got to just leave your expectations at the door, right? You can't just go into it and go, oh my gosh, how does this tie to what they did in this continuity or that continuity or this continuity? You kind of have to start approaching it with that G1 mindset and go, okay, look, the 84 comic had nothing to do with the 84 tune, but both were very cool in their own rights. We'll realize, again, that Beast Wars is the end game, but there's a lot of cool different ways that we got to Beast Wars. And this is another one of those very cool ways of how we got to the story of Beast Wars. And I'm excited to see it finished. I've been very happy with what I've seen so far. It's very different than the way I've always interpreted it, and that's what makes it kind of cool, is because it's different. I think that's what I love about Transformers more than, you know, Star Wars, which this is the continuity, or Star Trek, this is the continuity. I love Transformers because there's just so many continuities, and it's always been that way. And so that's what to expect out of the comic. It is an awesome story, but don't sit here and get hung up on the nuances of, you know, oh my gosh, how does this fit in with what was written 10 years ago or 20 years ago in this little...
You hear that, Dakota?
Yeah, no, I'm taking notes, like, send Pete hate mail on April the 11th. Like,
well, now, what? I just gave a completely compelling argument as to why...
No, I mean...
I like how you put it all back to, so you have to look at, like, G1, and I was like, exactly, you know, it was the best. So.
But at the same time, it's funny, because he was like, yeah, G1 was pretty poor compared to the, you know, masterpiece that Beast Wars was, and that I respect, so I don't know, like, I'm looking forward to it.
It's tough over, because we're fans of the properties, and it's never, you know, like anything, once other people start adding to it, it's never going to be, you know, exactly like what you want, or the, because I can't be in their minds, JP can't be in the minds of Bob and Larry, so I think you just have to, that's why, again, the multiverse is so awesome, because you don't have to step on any toes, because you can say, because really, honestly, the way I view it is that if you were I'll let this term's out there, a Beast Wars purist, you can say that there's Beast Wars and none of this other stuff, that's the continuity, that's fine. Because again, there are how many billions of continuities that have been established through Dreamwave and IDW and us and so on and so forth. I mean, you've got the movie, you've got everything, so, I mean, movie, the new, you know, Michael Bay movie, so, you know, again, apologies for the long-winded response. I guess I'm just trying to set expectations of not people expecting people to be like, okay, this has to be 100% pure of what the way I think that Beast Wars or everything we've heard before. You know, I just kind of like people to kind of go in with a little more open mind. And if I think you do, you'll realize that this is a really cool story. It definitely plays off some of the themes, and I think people will be really excited about it. So
it's funny because I think you're taking the approach to it like we're all, you know, the angry G1 fans. For the most part, I would say all of us Beast Wars fans are open-minded. You know, Josh doesn't like fun, so...
No, I'm like, do whatever you want to do with the Beast Wars story, you know? So, but, no, you know, G1, I mean, I had, you know, several different ways that, you know, the Constructicons came about, and, you know, so many different stories. So, I mean, I'm used to that, G1, yeah. So...
No, I mean, it's just, I like I said, I think it's...
We can move on to the next thing. So, do you have, I know you've shown us some stuff that we can't mention that, you know, that I don't know if you want to show off here or not, but if you have anything that you would like to show them, you are allowed to. Even the combiner?
I'm allowed? I was going to show you this. No. We don't want you showing that. I guess we'll let's go with something that Cybertron.com. Oh, you know what? But this is kind of cool.
Wow. When is that going to ship, by the way? Because
what is it?
I'm over here. I'm asking when that you have in your hand is going to ship, because I'm getting a little antsy.
This talk about great head sculpts. This head turned out fantastic too. That is a great looking. Now what's funny is they put the bar on the back. Oh, come on. Oh shit. I'm gonna pop the head off. I'm gonna pop the thing off. Well, I've had to finagle with it. I've already messed with it.
What was the issue?
I'm gonna rip the ball joint off. Oh, here we go. All right, I got it. So they put the bar across the back, and you can't see here because I showed it. But they put the bar that goes there, and when they did that, well, obviously the head couldn't tilt back, so it would look like his head was riding on top. So. I saw that. I got the sample, and I'm like, yeah, that's got to be redone. So they redid it. Perfect. The head tilts back like it was. I cut it out there to show them what I needed to do. So the head tilts back. He looks fantastic. Skywarp looks fantastic, too.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Dude. These colors pop. I mean, both of them. The colors just are fantastic. So that's Club. Oh, I don't know if I want to show this because it's not a good representation because the Tarantulas is wrong. I don't know.
Give the people what they want, Pete.
Give the people what they want. I'm not going to zoom in on it because the perspective is kind of weird on it. That is there. All right. So there he is. But what I'm going to do is take him apart here.
You're going to be able to show the head?
Yeah, I'm going to show you. Okay. I'm going to show you both heads because I did not show that to you last time.
I think we were looking at a black resin one last time.
Yeah. So
yeah, the shrunken ones.
That is the head. And this swivels, even though it doesn't need to. That's a whole other story. That swivels. So there's the Predicus head. That's not. There we go. Is that pretty clear?
It's about as clear as it usually gets.
Oh, not bad.
Well, you got your, 420p camera or whatever it is. So. I'm gonna go send you my old 720p.
This is a newer Mac. I don't know. It's a company computer. It has done me well. It has done me right. Oh, someone's gonna. Okay, this is the ugliest head sculpt we have ever done. Now, when I say ugly, that doesn't mean it's bad. It's just ugly. Ugly, ugly, ugly. But it had to be done. It had to be done.
Sell it, Pete. Sell it to us.
Look at that. Even the teeth. He's got those teeth. Oh, God, that's ugly.
Got him his little underbite going on.
Oh. Look at that ridge, though. They got the ridge. They got the ridge just right on his nose. Yeah, that is an ugly, ugly head sculpt.
But it's great to the CG render from the show.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's like they're all three of those are spot on.
Oh, by the way, they were red. They weren't gray. I don't care what anyone says. They were red. You look at the animation. They eventually shifted to red. We would have never made these toys gray and black. Boring, 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 boring. So that's that. What else? I ain't showing you anything else.
Nothing else for the people?
No.
You sure?
All right, we'll keep quiet. So.
Yeah.
All right, so we've got some questions here lined up for you, some stuff that we've asked. I think you previous in Cybercast and some new questions as well, but maybe we can get some updates.
I don't know. I'm debating now. I didn't ask the boss. I could just do it.
Let's do it. I mean, the time's now.
Yeah, you live in the now. Yeah.
Yeah, the show's less than a month away.
Nah, I better not. All right.
We'll ask some questions here. We'll see if you want to revisit it or not.
Maybe I'll revisit it.
Jaim, you want to get number one?
Sure. Registration went great this year compared to the previous one. Is the company that you use to process this one be used in the future? I guess the new processing company.
No matter how many times I seem to say this, I guess I've come to discover, unfortunately, life, that people often hear what they want to hear. No matter how hard I've tried to explain this, there's always going to be that small percentage that doesn't want to hear it. Or wants to hear what they want to hear. I will say it again. The company that we're working with, they bought out the company we've been working with prior. That company had everything. They had all of our stuff. They have it. They host it. We were in the process of, so we originally had the original registration system. We were in the process of upgrading that. Doing a new version, which would be able to be used by other outlets. We had bigger plans for it. The new company took over, and I may not be 100% exact on the timeline, but this is essentially what happened. At what point they came in? They came in. We could not get them to finish it. It was the biggest headache. The biggest headache in the world. That's over the top. It was a huge headache. Huge headache. That's why we had to go back to a broken version of the first one. And then we had to use a broken version of the second one. It never got done. We finally just threw up our arms and said, okay, this went to something else that we're still dealing with this other company. Can't get into all of it. But we do not have access to that second system we did right now. That is all being something that we are fighting with, and it is going to be a prolonged thing, I guess. The first system, we still had. We hired a new company. They were able to very quickly, as it should be, and very professionally, as it should be, rebuild that system into a perfectly working system. It has done great. As you see, there's been no problem. The hosting's fine. The speed is fine. Things don't time out. Yes, we wish we would have had them all along. Yes, we wish we would have bailed on the other company sooner. Absolutely. You know, but when you're there at that time, and this other company has all your stuff, and they kind of have you, you know, it's always easy to Monday morning quarterback or to be on the sidelines and say, oh, this is what I'd be doing without having all the facts. It was a giant nightmare. It's not nearly the nightmare it was. It's still kind of an issue. But yes, this new company is awesome. They are on top of everything. They communicate great. You don't have to wait for a week for a reply. They get back to you that same day. So it has been awesome. The registration went great for BotCon. It just opened up for Joe, 2 days ago on Thursday. Super smooth. Yes, that is the way it should work. And we are very thrilled with them. So I hope that answers your question.
Okay. Dakota, you want to get number two?
As far as guests are concerned, how often do you try to get, like, Colin and Welker? Is it every so often, every year, or no formula, and you just try to make it special?
Well, through Hasbro, so if you go back to 97, through, 2012, Peter Collins been to BotCon 7 times? Or 8 times. He was at our show in 2004, 97, 2004, 6, 8, 10. It's like 7 times. Seven, maybe 8, or at least 7. So we've had Peter 7. Of course, last year was the first year we've had Frank. It's his first show he's ever done. So, I don't know. I mean, we've only been able to have Frank once, so we wanted to do something. You know, we always want to do something new. We don't want to retread stuff, right? We don't want to do what someone else has already done. So we got Frank last year, and this year it was very much about getting Judd.
We've had 2017, Shia LaBeouf.
I don't. I would love to have him in the BotCon. Absolutely, that would be personally one of the coolest things.
Mark Wahlberg, though. Like, let's start talking better. I'm sorry. Yeah. I got you off topic.
So we had Frank. We had Peter 7 times. Possibly 8. We've got Judd this year, and I am super stoked about that. And there you go.
All right, have you received the second samples of the BotCon figures? And if so, how did they come? Did they come out the way you wanted? You mentioned that you preferred flat paint over the gloss on a certain character's head. Did they correct that? Have you got those back in yet?
I did not get second samples on everything. I got second samples on some of them. Some of them came in without their heads. For instance, the C-clamp came in without his head. I got a version with the head. The souvenir and the freebie, the centerpiece souvenir, the freebie came in without heads, got corrected versions with the heads. Any other ones? China did send us photographs, pictures, whatever, spreadsheet, spotlighting, circles, the whole 9 yards. So they gave it to us the best they could on the timeline we were on as far as trying to get all this stuff done. Most everything that I wanted corrected was the gloss heads. It's hard to tell from a picture. I don't think they were changed, but I think they all have gloss heads, or at least 2 of the 3 have gloss heads, but I saw them together, and it doesn't really look off, so I'm okay with it. You know, it's just one of those things where, again, you got a timeline, and you have to meet that production timeline, so you're not going to get everything. My feeling is I got everything that I thought was important. I've talked about the Ravage last time, that we've got a small fix for that. I would have liked to have maybe changed that head a little bit as far as the way the ball joint worked. you know, we had time to do it for the free figure for Ramjet and Skywarp because we weren't on a hard deadline. So, you know, those are going to be pushed back a little bit as far as when we get them to people. But, you know, by a couple weeks, 3 weeks maybe. Not like, you know, we didn't have that extra 3 or 4 weeks with Ravage or any of the other toys. So, you know, looking around, I mean, yeah, everything. Yeah, like the colors on one of the other Combiner Wars souvenirs, I think they fixed the colors. Someone else, there was paint on his nose, shouldn't have been there. They took that off. So little things like that. So, yeah, we're in pretty good shape.
Okay. Four Horsemen has done a great job with the Masters of the Universe, and from what we can see at this point, Thundercats as well. Having them work on this year's Botcon set, is this relationship going to continue to grow in the future, and how was it like working with them?
They're great. they've been great. Boss Fight's been great. I will say this. People have kind of given me a hard time in the past for over-promising and maybe under-delivering. When it came to some of the head sculpts, I think sometimes I commented at the concept stage, and like for instance, like the Overlord didn't turn out the best. Gigatron from 2012, and the Metal Hawk head was a little off. I commented from the drawings, and you know we weren't using the digital turns at that time. It was still all by hand, plus the factor we used for the Metal Hawk head didn't usually do humans. So there was just some things, and you know, this was 4 years ago. The way I've handled situations have also improved since then. So I kind of get that one thrown back at me a little bit. I will say this, and unless something has happened, let me preface it. Unless something happened between the final production version I got and the one that's going to come out, the head for the centerpiece toy that we did is probably, in my view, if not one of the best Beast War head sculpts people have ever seen. It may be, I mean, not just of what we've done. I mean, I think done, period. It is unbelievable. It is just, I want to just pick him up and show it right now, but I'm not going to. He is just fantastic. It is incredible. People are going to flip when they see it. The details are just unreal. The paint, the way they got the head, it's just unreal. Absolutely unreal. So I'm very, very, so basically suffice to say I'm very excited about that. I don't know what the question was. What was the question? Oh, Four Horsemen. So obviously, they've done a fantastic job. Their turns have been great. They've been, you know, like I said, I think there was a little bit of a learning curve there because the first batch of heads I got from them were not sized right. So we were kind of still, like, you know, if they fully had a grasp on what, you know, things we could do, what we needed them to do, what was going to be done. Once we kind of iron that out, that's why you send low-res copies. And that's why it's so much better working off of digital terms where they can send you prints. Once we got that ironed out, it worked great. The 4.0 is fantastic. I've got the actually, I've got it here. Have we shown this? Yeah, we've shown this, haven't we? Yeah. Sometimes I have to think for a second. So this is the head for the 5.0 Monkey Prime. I've got, what is it?
You couldn't see it.
Well, I know, you can't see it yet because I got finished talking.
Oh, hold on. I'm sorry.
No, I'm just giving you a hard time. I know, because you thought I was going to, but I started going to something else. They've got to fix the ball underneath his head. I'm having them kind of tweak that. So this actually is a high-res print, but they're going to send me a new one that we'll send to China. But I don't know if you're going to be able to see. Oh, so that is the Prime head. Oh.
Looks good.
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah, it looks really good. It's going to be wild. I think we're really excited about the, they were, at least the word from what I read, they seem to be pretty excited about the Monkey Pretender.
You know, there's so much everything rolled up into that one figure. Like, I'm very excited about that one.
What about you, Hex? I mean, it's like G1, but it's like, Beast Wars, kind of. It's like Chuck and it has a monkey.
Yeah, if it's got that G1 to it, yeah. I like that one thing that you showed us.
No,
I'm probably buying that. So.
Yeah, I don't blame it.
Let's see, Dakota, you want to get the number 5?
Looking at
Yes, Four Horsemen has been awesome. They are great. We're working with them on 5.0, obviously. We worked with them on the Joe toys. The Joe sculpts have been phenomenal. So yes, they have been great to work with. Great to work with. Go on. Sorry. There you go.
I sound so defeated. All this Beast War talk, and then Jaim is talking about Beast Wars tonight. It's a
perfect night to be a fan of Beast Wars.
You guys are piling on me,
dude. You're just gonna have to get in the back seat, man.
Have I not said the troop builder is not Beast Wars, right? I think I've said that.
You haven't said that, but now we know.
You said it was the custom class.
Yeah.
And
custom class isn't Beast Wars, and the troop builder is not Beast Wars.
And they are what again?
All right. All right, Dakota, number 5.
Looking at the Titan Returns line, upcoming figures, are there any that you see that you think, oh, we could do that with that mold?
Yep.
That's Fort Max, right?
You're gonna make another
I'm not gonna tell you what that is, but I'll answer your question. Yeah, we can think of stuff to do with any mold. Some of it would probably be lousy. Some of it would probably be awesome. But you know, it's as long as the base toy's there. The great thing about Transformers line is that how do I say it? Sometimes there weren't. Certain lines, there weren't as many molds that we could use to be premium exclusive molds. With the way the brand has gone, with this kind of having Combiner Wars and Classics and these things that are just totally focused on really kind of the collector and also having that kid appeal but really kind of hitting the collector, our options have been, we've had a lot more options and greater options. So,
okay. I guess we've already hounded you about number 6. So, what are the prices of some of the souvenir figures for this year?
So we are selling them all separately this year. Troop builder, and then there'll be souvenir 1, 2, 3, 4. Troop builder, class kit. Right? Yeah. So I usually work with Brian on the pricing. I usually kind of submit what I'm thinking. He's usually good with it. Sometimes there's tweaks made, so I can't really tell you that pricing yet because I haven't submitted it yet. That will go in the that will be in the program that we're working on. Actually, I guess we'll be working on that next week. So okay. I can't really know the pricing. It's not really out of whack. Centerpiece is going to be a little bit, nothing over $100. The troop builder should actually be cheap, be much cheaper than usual. I can tell you that right now because we had this we did one too many wasps apparently. The War Rooters 4-pack was $149. Which worked out to like $35 each, but it was still just, too out there, I think, in hindsight. But, yeah, this year's troop builder don't come anywhere near that. Okay. Nowhere close. So,
Jaim, do you want to do 9 since 8 was kind of answered in the comic?
You sure you don't want to do 9? It's right up your alley.
All right, well.
You just carry, I'll do 10, you do 9.
Gotcha, all right. So how's the little Hex figure, or bio, whichever one it's going to be, and is that a real thing, or you just been, like, joking with me this entire time?
Did you guys see that, did you see that Jimmy Kimmel sketch the other night? Batman.
I don't think so.
He had Ben Affleck on. And
I saw Matt Damon in his jacket, that one.
Well, after that, I guess, he had Ben Affleck, and two of them were talking. And they were talking.
Yeah. And he had him in like kind of the trailer where he was walking back and forth and like, dude, you're Batman and you're Superman.
But do you remember the setup to that though? What Ben was trying to tell Jimmy was that, you know, Jimmy had a part in the movie. But sometimes, you know, his part was so good, but it was so brief that it just like overshadowed the rest of the movie. So instead of giving them that little bit of awesomeness,
that's me.
They had to take it out because look, here's what happened: the hex thing we wrote was so great and so awesome, but we were afraid it was going to make all the other tech specs look kind of weak. So we had to take that out because it would have just overshadowed everything else, and I couldn't have that. So it was.
He walks away. We don't want the value to shoot up like the dark side of Megatron, you know, all that type of stuff.
It might be in the DVD cut of the tech specs, but no, I don't know. We'll still. I know we had a conversation, and I don't know if it was water in my drink that night. It was, but well, you'll have to tell me again offline what exactly I said, and then I'll work it in. We'll put it in somewhere.
You're using the mock kick mold. Making an Hexatron out of it.
All right.
So I'll go to number two.
So eventually, I usually do little shout outs here and there.
I'm not asking questions. You guys take the rest of them over.
All right. Number 10. For those that don't know, what is the show dollar prize for the cosplay contest, and will any cosplay, maybe not Transformers, be accepted?
But did he write this one too? No, we're not. Kylo Emo Ren is not going to be allowed to cosplay.
Did you call him Emo Ren?
Emo Ren.
Kylo Ren, because they've got that Twitter handle. It's I think
you need to quit putting labels on people, Pete. We're people too.
So as long as you do your hair black, if you have your hair in black. No Kylo, and that's pretty much the only restriction, right? Yeah, no Kylo.
I got my Cobra Commander out.
You know what? People can cosplay as someone else if they want, but since we have judges, I don't think we're going to pick them no matter how good they are. I mean, that'd be kind of weird, right? And the winner is Spock.
Okay, well, you know, got our answer.
If you can like tie a theme into it, like it, I'm a huge football fan, and it, you know, down here in Cincinnati, we got this guy that dresses up as a stormtrooper, but he's in orange and black. So if you come with like Kylo and he's got like giant like Autobot symbol, or does that, well, actually it'd be a Decepticon symbol, or if like his lightsaber. He has like a shield, maybe. You know, if you want to add some Transformer element to it, that might increase your chances of being the winner.
There you go.
He puts a tiny little Decepticon Reaper label on the helmet.
If you dressed up as a Beast Wars character, Josh, I think you would win, just for the sheer fact that you're dressed up as a Beast Wars.
Dakota and I were going to rent one of those like two-man horses or whatever.
But no, the prize is what, $250 in show dollars, and you get to spend that within the dealer room. I don't know. Second place is getting to hang out with Kylo Ren all day Saturday. So.
All right.
There's gonna be a tantrum there. There's gonna be a lightsaber thrown across the table.
All right, Dakota.
Any details you can give us on next year's Transformers figure subscription service figures, theme, anything like that, how they tie into the story?
So let's see, 5.0. We've announced that. We'll be talking about it at Botcon, I'm sure. You've got the Truck Monkey, and you've got the Paradrawn Medic, who we will be giving a name to. Everyone's like, she needs a name, she needs a name. She'll have a name. So we're going to name her after 20, 30 years. Doesn't mean the one from G1 that's the same name as her, because I'm not a big fan of going back and giving names to things in someone else's continuity, something else someone else did. Her name was Paradrawn Medic. I leave it alone. But our Paradrawn Medic, in the continuity she's in...
G1 Exatron. Wow. You could name it G1 Exatron.
So, she will have a name. I don't know what it is yet. And then the theme ties into... Have we announced the theme? No, we have not. We'll talk about that at BotCon.
All right. What will we see in the future of the Transformer-style G.I. Joes? Any new stuff? I know you talked about the only human stuff, but what's up with my boy Chip?
We're still working with Boss Fight on the wheelchair you said we had to have. I think I've announced that we've got another one planned. Yeah, we've got another one planned that we will also be talking about at BotCon.
Okay.
So in addition to Rodimus and RC, yes.
Awesome. RC, I swear I can't remember what I've talked about and what I haven't. I guess, but this isn't that big of a deal. RC, I think I've said this, but I haven't shown it. RC does get a new head done by Boss Flight. So we couldn't find any Joe heads that really worked for her. Number of female heads. There are... There's a lot of female heads that work great for a ton of characters. None of them have that 80s bun thing, whatever that hairstyle was that she had. There was a great figure of... I believe she's out. I shouldn't say anything. She came out in the last subscription. No, wait. She is not out.
Talking about Marissa?
No. You gotta be careful.
Come on, Pete. You can do it. Just give the people what they want, man.
Hold on. Give me 5 seconds. I'm happy to tell you. I just don't want to make sure I... Oh yeah, she's out. Okay. So the GI that was from 3.0. I don't know. I just gotta make sure that Joe isn't always. Where'd you guys go? There you are. It was the GI Joe Bomb Strike figure we did. She had short hair down to here, but it was kind of a it was more of a 2000s cut. It was kind of like you'd have to look her up, but it was kind of all one length around.
The can I speak to the manager, please? Haircut.
The cover girl look.
No, it wasn't that one. It was all the way around. It was like all one length. But it's a great head sculpt. It's beautiful. But we originally were going to use it, and I'm looking at it, and I'm like, that's just really not. That could be like, or it could totally be RC from Only Human in 2005, if it was actually made in 2005 and not 1986. But it just didn't work. So I got approval to do a new one, and we did a new one, and it should be pretty pimp. So there you go.
All right, number 13. So is it safe to assume BotCon and the Transformers collectors or subscription service will be around next year?
We have announced everything we can about it at this time.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So, yeah. I wish I could completely comment on everything.
Gotcha.
You can put me on the record for that. So, things are what they are right now, and we're just focused on right now, and I'm sure by BotCon there will be a clear vision of the future for everybody involved.
All right, Jaim, why don't you get the JoeCon questions?
Okay.
You can tackle all this.
Just some quick questions on JoeCon, like where is it this year? When is it? The theme?
Joe's show is in Loveland, Colorado, about an hour north of Denver. It is June what? Isn't that awful? I never know. I don't know it off the top of my head. That's why it's on the calendar, so I don't have to remember off the top of my head. It's June, so what? Oh, I don't know. Hold on. Jeez, I gotta know this stuff. June something. I worry about that the day after BotCon. 16th to the 19th here in Loveland. The theme is Sky Patrol. The figures are awesome. Total 90s feel. So, as someone who loves G2 and Machine Wars, it is a total throwback to that. The response has been great so far. You know, the usual kind of nitpicks back and forth, but for the most part, I think people are pretty pleased with the theme. The souvenirs look great. So I think people will get a big kick. I think Joe fans will be pretty excited. The head boss fight did the head sculpts. Head sculpts are fantastic, again. Absolutely. I worked with them on those, so they turned out great. There you go.
Okay. Last question for the JoeCon. What makes it like unique, and or like how would you sell it to like someone who is a fan of Joe's? I mean, besides being official.
To be blunt, I mean, there's not much Joe stuff going on right now, unfortunately. So, you know, we've been very honored to be able to and pleased and happy and whatever average it to kind of carry on the line while it's being whatever they're doing up at where their future plans are for it and how to kind of bring it back. So we've been kind of just carrying that on. And, you know, if you're a Joe fan, this is really kind of your outlet for G.I. Joe right now. And we work closely with Hasbro and all this stuff and have been doing it for years now. 20 years we've been involved with G.I. Joe. So actually, yeah, I think this is our 20th G.I. Joe convention. So yeah, if you're into G.I. Joe and you know love the mythos and love the brand, we got Larry Hama will be there. So he is kind of the, you know, for anyone, I mean, I'm assuming everybody here knows, but Larry Hama is the Simon Furman / Bob Budiansky of Transformers. So even more so, I could say he wrote the entire run of the G.I. Joe comic, so gave the characterizations, I think, for the cartoon as well. I could be wrong. I think so. Yeah.
He's the godfather of G.I. Joe.
Yeah, but he's done awesome work with that mythos, and he'll be there. Kirk Bazigian will be there, who was the brand director for the line back in the 80s. We've got another guest who still got announced. So, yeah, come on out. If you're in the Colorado area, you know, even if you're just a casual fan, if you're not someone who's diehard into Joe, but kind of love the 80s stuff, come on out for the day. I think it's like $20, $25 to get in. You know, come hang out for the day. It's a blast. You know, and that's the cool thing about Joe, and that is the one difference between Joe and Transformers, which is a cool thing if you're a collector, is that, as you know, well, back in the 90s BotCons, there would be plenty of G1 stuff, but it's not nearly as prevalent on the BotCon floor because a lot of it has been just gobbled up in collectors' hands. But there is, because Joe is a little bit of a smaller fan base, and I don't know if they were just producing some stuff in just larger quantities or what, but or if there's just people that have got dealers on that side that are just able to get their hands on stuff. But there is a great selection of vintage G.I. Joe at G.I. Joe Con each year, the 80s stuff. I mean, there's vintage 12-inch stuff, too, but the 80s stuff, there's one guy there, Chris Neal, who just has an amazing display every year. Just like it's like walking into a store from the 80s. It's just awesome. So
the good stuff.
Cool.
It is. It's a phenomenal. And there's always like one guy, which makes me happy, because I do appreciate Joe, but I am a Transformer guy. There's always one guy, it's not always the same guy, that will have a good setup of Transformer stuff. So I'm like... I have found a couple gems at the Joe Show. So who knows what you might find there? Your transfer, you might find that piece at a relatively good price you've been looking for. So
cool. Just a quick question. I know that you go back and forth with Hasbro with the Transformers, but since G.I. Joe is kind of almost not dead, but they're not really, you don't know what they're doing with it. Do you have issues getting approval from Hasbro for certain themes?
No, there's the Joe team. I mean, they're actively working on bringing that brand, bringing the brand back in a new way. I'm not really privy to those conversations, we don't have communication has been great with them, so yeah, no problems. Cool.
All right, Dakota, start us off on. We got just a couple of questions for a getting to know Pete question. So these don't have to be long drawn out. They can kind of be a little quicker. But Dakota, you want to kick off number one?
Are there any other lines besides Transformers that you collect?
This is going to take about 15 minutes there, Hex. Geez. I'm going to list all of them. I'm going to list every single one. No, actually, no. There isn't.
What?
I'll pick up, like, a little thing here or there if I see something that's kind of cool. Like, I grab, like, a Deadpool. I have, like, this little case right here in the side of my room that's kind of got some Batman, some Turtles, some old school Pony, some Star. It's, like, a small case, too.
Oh, thank you. We've seen that before.
Have I shown that before?
Yeah. I think we've seen it before.
Yeah, so, I mean, that little thing right there, and I've got, like, four or five boxes of 90s stuff downstairs still. Not even big boxes, and I just need to get rid of it. I mean, it just sits in boxes, you know. Which remind me at the end, because I've got some news. I've got personal news. Personal news.
Okay. We're almost done here. Do you buy any outside sourced, officially licensed stuff? Like, you have the Kids Logic Transformers. You have the Prime One Studios. You know, stuff like that to where it's not made by Hasbro Takara, but it is officially licensed by them.
To be straight up, I don't really buy anything anymore. Nothing modern, anyways. At a couple shows last year, I filled in some holes for my vintage collection. You know, I think I've kind of shown my office. My office at this point is really kind of focused, like, outside of the stuff right here, which is stuff we work on. Anything else is all pretty much 84 to 2001. I kind of consider everything up to 2001 like vintage at this point because it's been that long. Kind of scary. I mean, we were calling G1 vintage back in 95, 96, and here we are 15 years away from RID, further away than we were from G1 back then. So, no, not really. I mean, like I said, I've got some holes, but it's literally on one page. I've got, like, maybe 10, 12 items I'd like to get that would kind of fill in some holes. But, I have everything from 84 to 90 loose. I have the original 72 all sealed. I've got, you know, all the Action Masters sealed. I've got, like, another little cool thing. I've got, like, the 6 Throttle Bots all sealed with red Decepticon decoys. So I've got, like, little niche sections, like little cutouts of that. I've got, like, you know, four of the two Pretenders vehicles and the two bigger ones, like the Roadbuster and Skyhammer, those four and that group, like, deal. So, like, little things like here and there. That's kind of like my thing. But as far as anything, I'm not trying to, like, you know, here's what I got. I'm just saying that's been my focus, and this is some of the stuff I've had for 20 years.
Gotcha.
Longer than 20 years. I started collecting sealed G1 stuff back in 92. So that's kind of my thing. So I guess I'm just at the point that I'm just kind of like, I kind of like focus on my stuff, and I totally dig all the stuff we do. Sounds awful. I don't like it if Hasbro does it, but we do it. It's great. No, I kind of focus on working on what we work on, and then if I add anything, it's to my vintage stuff. But as far as anything modern, I just don't. Except, well, Masterpiece. I get some Masterpiece. I take that back. And I do keep, like, and I have kept, like, a selection of the I shouldn't say it's all 2000 left. I've kept the selection of like the universe stuff and the generation stuff, like the Devastator, the ones that I really dig, and I have like all the animated stuff loose. But that'll all go back into what I'm going to talk about at the end here. So, anyways, that's that.
All right, number three. What is
that? Well, maybe you want to move to four since you didn't.
Okay, so number four, from the new lines like Visionaries, Mask, etc., is there anything that you would like to work on for the club?
Mask seems like the automatic. I mean, that would be... I would love to see those little... What are they, two-inch figures, I guess, would be the mask? I would love to see those with modern tooling in vehicles. I mean, that it kind of seems like an automatic. I mean, between... that would be your Joe Transformers mask crossover. Good grief. But yeah, I would love to see the mask toys in like a, you know, whatever modern vehicles, semis, sports cars, you know, that dude in a Bugatti or a, you know, whatever type of Porsche or whatever. So yeah, that'd be pretty kick ass.
Cool.
Dakota.
Are you a fan of the Bayformers? be honest.
God.
And are you excited to see the announcement of three new films that aren't Beast Wars, unfortunately?
Please, if you personally do not like something, please disparage it here publicly. So, I mean, you realize there's only one right answer. I'm not saying whether I do or not. There's, like, literally only one right answer to that question. I will only talk about the first movie. I'm not going to go into fanboy mode on the other ones of what you could do or couldn't do. I thought the first movie was great. I think it's actually one of the best stories. It was a very cohesive story. Yes, you can nitpick it. You can nitpick every story. As far as what it was, and I did not consider it just a popcorn movie. I thought it was a well thought out and a well written movie. I thought it was fun. I thought there was enough comic relief. I thought it was great. I enjoy that movie. I enjoy the entire Beast Wars. Of all Beast Wars, the Agenda series, the last three episodes of season two of the Agenda were great. Transformers movie, those are, you know, kind of like as far as live action tune, not comics, but as far as like something, you know, visual that you watch, you know, Beast Wars, the move, Transformers movie, and the 2007 movie are probably my top three favorites. You know, as far as the other ones, I mean, you know, it's, I mean, you know, there's been, there's been issues, of course. You know, I think, you know, that they've people that work on it talk about it. So I think that there's been some kind of rebooting. I think of the way I'm assuming that they've kind of rebooted the way they've looked at it, going forward. You know, I guess the only thing personally I would say is I would like to see him appeal to smaller kids a little bit, just so I could take my son to see it. So we'll have to see what 5 is. I hope it's great.
All right, and lastly, you said you collect some masterpieces. What are kind of your favorite masterpieces, and what are some of the, maybe the ones that you don't like as much?
I don't pay as a close attention to those, just because I know this breaks your heart, just because we don't actually aren't working on those right now and have no plans for any as an exclusive. Did he leave? I don't know. No. Soundwave's great. I thought the Prime's great. I think the only ones I really that appeal to me personally are the straight up 84. 85 cast, so I guess I would like to get that Ironhide. I guess he's gotten really good reviews, and I guess a Bumblebee and a Wheeljack. I've got Sideswipe, and I've got Smokescreen and Blue Streak and G2 Sideswipe, so I'd like to get 3 or 4 more. So, yeah.
They're good.
They're good. Where are yours? I don't even see them. Are they...
I've got... a lot over there on the shelf, and then there's a bunch of them here. The shelf needs rearranged. But other than the bathing apes, I have all of them. So
how many are there now? I don't even know.
Well, they're up to, what, 28, but then there's the variants.
Well, there, and then there's all the cassettes, so there's over 45 of them, because I think... if you take Sound Blaster, he comes with...
forget about cassettes. The cassettes. The actual, like, just... Anybody over 6 inches, how many are there?
Oh, I'd say there's at least 35.
Really?
Well, like, Skywarp takes the same number scheme as Starscream, Thundercracker. You have Acid Storm. You have Sunstorm. All those repaints of the Seekers.
Is that the current tooling? Like this current masterpiece line? Or are you considering like the older ones from 10 years ago?
I just kind of counted 38 real quick.
I always count from MP08 like forward.
All the way to 8, wow.
Yeah, because it's Grimlock, and then you had Rodimus Convoy, and then that's whenever your new Prime came out.
Yeah, 10, yeah.
I mean, kind of everything before that was just... I mean, it was there, it was cool, but it was all... It wasn't quite... I don't think it was quite as focused as...
They've redone the Seekers to MP11 and did that, so...
Magnus has had a redo.
I've got the Skywarp. I get the... We get samples of stuff, but not usually the mask. But that was because I guess Skywarp was released here, though. So, yeah. All right, cool. All right, well, I guess I need to research that a little bit more.
All right. So, what's your announcement, or do you have anything that you decided you wanted to show off? Or?
Oh, gosh. Hint, hint, wink, wink.
Camera's on you.
Camera can be moved to the left a little bit.
You got 40-something people that we still have live here. So, and then plus, you know, like 1,000 or so that'll watch in video form. So, people are in the chat. They're saying, "Do it, Pete."
I'm sure they are.
Peer pressure.
Peer pressure. And the first one that said it was one that's actually, you know, he's going, he signed up for the custom class and all that stuff. So.
Mm-hmm. And he lives in Colorado, and he's going to JoeCon.
Yep. Hey, you going to go to JoeCon, Dalton? Live in Colorado. That state's not too big. I don't think it is. It's not Texas big. So they're mocking... Shia LaBeouf now. Just do it! Just... They're all saying, do it, Pete. Do it for the people.
Do it for the nerds.
Someone said no pressure, but don't just ignore that one. You got UK, we have Barrett Prime that's from the UK. He's going to be coming to the US for the first time to go to Botcon.
It's like 4 a.m. over there. Dude, go to sleep.
He's dedicated.
He is dedicated.
Oh, man, I so want to.
Real quick on the MP talk, though, it's not counting cassettes, but counting all of the released MPs, there's 50. According to this one guy that I haven't, like, researched myself, but hey.
No pressure, but Josh has 2 hitmen with snipers trained on
him. Little red dots start appearing. Oh, he grabbed something.
Uh-oh.
Split second, isn't it?
I want to see that face.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's cool.
Ooh.
All right.
I like what I see. I know exactly what I saw, and I like it.
No, you don't. I made that up. I custom made it.
Yeah, it was something that someone painted up for you, but, you know, right. It would be nice.
Well,
so, Pete, before you left, you said you wanted to sell a bunch of stuff or something?
Where'd you get that?
I don't know. You said you had all these boxes, which reminds me, bring that up to me.
Okay, well, I was like, did I already talk about this somewhere? I made a decision back in, I don't mean to make like a big deal about this, but, you know, anybody that has collected with me, I collected, you know, with John and Carl, we were doing the same shows and kind of, you know, going after the same stuff back in the day, and Tony Prito and Raksha and kind of all the that old school group. But I kind of made the decision back in I was at Botcon last year, and I kind of was looking around the dealer room with some stuff I wanted to get, and kind of finally some G1 reissues, and it kind of finally hit me. I was like, you know what? I don't have the plate. If I get them, I don't really display package stuff anymore, other than my G1 display that I've got here, like 8 feet, whatever, or 6 feet even, except for that kind of this G1 package section. Everything else that I have packages and boxes. So if I buy like the reissue set of whatever, I think it was like the classics, because I like wanted to get like every version of them, and I was trying to keep up with it. I've already gotten rid of all the movie stuff I had and all this stuff from 2002, 2003. But I still had all my vintage stuff. I had all the classic stuff. I had all the animated stuff. So I still had like all the Beast Wars stuff. I have them loose, but I also, back in the day, I was a collector. Not like you're not a collector if you don't, but I'm saying one loose, one packaged. All variations, period. It was a lot easier in the 90s. So, anyways, I'm at Botcon. And I was still trying to kind of keep up with some of the stuff that I was getting. And I finally just thought to myself, you know what? It's just going to go in a box. And I finally thought, all right, it's time. So I am selling off at Botcon this year about 50 boxes worth of stuff. It is a ton of G2, everything from Beast Wars, everything from Beast Machines, everything from RID, everything from and this is the sealed stuff. So like I said, I keep one sealed. Keep one loose. A bunch of promotional stuff, some displays, all kinds of crazy stuff. So there will be a lot of stuff there. So when John and Carl sold off did their first collection sell off, and then they did their second one, this is kind of my part one. I don't know when part two will be. I'm of the belief you can't take it with you, so I have no intention of dying with this stuff in my possession still. But I am very happy with my office and everything that's in here. But everything else that is not in here, that is in all those boxes, for the most part, I'm keeping about 8-9 boxes of kind of random stuff that fits into what I collect. But as far as the bulk of it, all the G2, Beast Wars, Beast Machines, a bunch of Beast Wars stuff from Japan, RID, the car robot stuff, other stuff. So that actually this is part two, because I'd already sold off a bunch of modern stuff a couple years ago, but this is like the core of my sealed collection outside of my 80s G1 stuff.
So that's I have it. A list I'm gonna send you later on tonight.
One of the things as a collector you don't do, at least we didn't do back in the day. I know John and Carl's collection was kind of out there because they brought all the Botcon 94, but I never talked about what I collected. I didn't need to. I didn't tell people what I collected. I didn't tell them how big or not big my collection was. I was always very quiet. I didn't come into this role of a more public role until I started with Fun Club. I always was kind of just happy to be a collector. So, but, you know, I want people to know that, I'm going to have, it won't be me. I'm working. So I won't be selling it. I actually have a job, so I will be there doing that job. So I will not be selling it off. But I have people that will be selling it off on my behalf. So I hope there should be a lot of cool stuff that you don't usually see at a Botcon. So
cool.
Now, I'm looking for a green Ramulus.
All right. Well, you can. Yeah.
Hex doesn't even know what that is.
He does. I mean, he knows because he teased me with it 2 years
ago.
We did a little prank video.
And he went nuts. And then he cussed us all out. So, anyway.
There it is. So, yeah. So, So people will be hawking my wares. So.
I'll make my way over there with some Pete coupons and stuff like that.
You collect G2? I've got a
I'm selling all my G1 stuff, or most of it.
Well, what do you collect? Just the Masterpiece?
Yeah, well, I'm adding on Masterpiece, and then I'm doing Hot Toys and He-Man and Thundercats, so I'm kind of expanding into different stuff, so. Yeah, I'm sorry, man. Okay. All right, okay. Well, I want to thank you for coming on, Pete. And, touching on some Botcon stuff and also some of the, collector's stuff as well. So definitely appreciate it. And we'll see you in less than a month, man. So
are all three of you going to be there? I know you're going to be there.
I won't be there, no. I can't make it.
Oh. All right. Dakota will be there a week and a half ahead of time, just like camping out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Since Hex is riding with me, like, he has to camp out with me.
All right, cool. Well, thank you guys for having me on again and let me just ramble on about everything. I hope it's somewhat informative. So.
Yeah, I'm sure there will be someone that will rewatch this and then start to do the whole piece together and put this like thing on a forum. So that's usually what someone does.
Well, that's good. I mean, like I said, I come on here because I want to make sure that we can get as much information out to people. I mean, I do want to communicate, kind of let people know what's going on and it's a closing note. I mean, this show is going to be, Botcon is going to be, I think, a pretty epic show this year. We've got, it's going to be a blast. I think you're going to have a blast. Obviously, Code is going to be in heaven. So,
yeah.
I mean, all right. Well, I appreciate it.
All right, Ben. We'll talk to you here in about a month, okay?
I'll see you then.
See you later, man.
See you.
Bye.
All right, guys, so we have a little bit of, new stuff that I want to go kind of touch on real quick, and then we'll kind of move on to the screen share. But as far as trailers, the Ghostbuster trailer is up on the Facebook page. You guys, are y'all excited about that?
No.
Me neither.
I like that the original, song was in it, I guess.
Yeah, kind of redone or whatever.
Trying to be positive about it.
I saw some people that, I'm not going to name any names here, but where if you, whenever it's like, I didn't like that trailer, I thought it was crap, that it was like an attack on women or something like that. I was like, no, it's because the trailer was crap. It has nothing to do with characters being female. I could care less on that, so. All right, but a couple of other things is Daredevil Season 2 Trailer Part 2 is up on the Facebook page, and also RID Season 2 Episode 1, 2, and 3 just went up today. All right, a couple of news things here. If there's something here that you want to talk more about, let me know. Just stop me. Straight Up Films has acquired the film rights to Square Enix video game franchise Thief and plans to make a Thief movie. Star Wars: The Force Awakens will be coming to Blu-ray April 5th. Target, Walmart, Best Buy, and the Disney Store will have exclusive releases.
Great. There's more stuff to buy.
I think the other ones are like some special, like Best Buy's like a 10, and Walmart's like you get like a lithograph, or maybe that's the Disney Store. Target, though, you get like deleted scenes and
bonus disc.
Like additional footage. So I'm gonna get the Target one.
Yeah.
Let's see here. Producer of the Justice League movie. That while Green Lantern is left out, we may or may not see him introduced until Justice League 2. My little question to you guys is: do you want Hal Jordan or John Stewart? I prefer John Stewart.
Hal Jordan.
I would rather John Stewart.
Yeah. Right. Whatever. All right, you guys watch too much Justice League.
It's a Justice League movie.
No, you're watching the Bruce Timm Justice League. You've never seen the original comics.
Yeah, that's what I like.
So that's where that's coming from.
All right, and ABC has renewed new seasons for Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., just for Dakota, Once Upon a Time, and Quantico. Warner Brothers is aiming to shoot Suicide Squad's sequel as early as 2017. Wow. Disney XD will begin airing a Big Hero 6 series in 2017. Dakota's favorite show, Fuller House, gets season 2 ordered by Netflix, so they're already greenlighting that.
Yeah.
TNT is working on a new sci-fi series titled Artificial Intelligence, kind of based off of the movie. I like the movie by itself. I don't know if I'm really going to dig a series.
Now, where is my continuation of Here Comes Honey Boo Boo?
Honey Boo Boo.
That's what we all need.
I don't even know what that is, to be honest. So.
It's sad. It's what it is.
All right, The League's Katie Asselton. I have no idea if I'm saying that correctly. I mean, it's seven letters, so probably not. Is joining FX's X-Men spinoff Legion. Video game Uncharted 4 has changed its release date to April 26th, or from April 26th to May 10th. So it's been pushed 2 weeks. Nickelodeon is making a Legends of the Hidden Temple TV movie. You guys remember that little game show, Legends of the Hidden Temple, on Nickelodeon?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was more of a Double Dare fan, but yeah, sure.
See, I liked Hidden Temple, except for I always got irritated with the kids because it's like whenever they got up there, that none of them had watched the show before, so they don't know the obstacle course. I'm like, dude, I'd know that thing in and out. Boy, I'd be right through there like the Flash. So, all right, so Lionsgate has started filming on the new Power Rangers movie. Dakota, I'm sorry, but the Gambit movie has been removed from its scheduled release date of October 7, 2016 for the time being.
I am happy about that.
Fox Marvel Films have slated two untitled movies for October 6, 2017 and January 12, 2018. One of them may possibly be a Deadpool sequel. Alien Covenant has moved up 2 months to August 4th, 2017. The Predator has been scheduled for release of March 2nd, 2018.
Oh, wow.
Netflix series Iron Fist will star Finn Jones as Iron Fist. The Wolverine's Jaim Mangold will direct Disney's Captain Nemo movie. I'm excited about that movie. Ted Sears will join 24 Legacy as the head of CTU. That's the guy playing, or I guess he did play until Zoom killed him. What's that guy's name?
Who?
On The Flash.
Oh, Jay Garrick?
Yeah. He was playing him, so that's who that
is. Who was actually Zoom? Spoiler! Yeah.
Ooh. Don't do it to him, Jay!
Sorry, wrong show. I'll do it on my show.
All right, Steve DeKnight will direct Pacific Rim 2 with a August 4th, 2017 release date. I know James is excited about that, so they need some more NECA figures.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Batman vs. Superman will be getting an extended version on Blu-ray, which will be rated R for violence.
Nice.
NBC has added Vanessa Hudgens, Danny Pudi or something, Alan Tudyk, and
he's probably like watching. Damn it! Why you messing up my name?
The cast.
Oh, this is Leo's favorite show. Now it's not mine.
DC's Powerless. All right, Justice League will begin filming April 11th. Sony Pictures has revived plans for a standalone Venom movie, unrelated to the upcoming Spider-Man. And Hasbro applies for the trademark for Omega Supreme and Vector Prime as far as toys. We know what that's for. So. And Hasbro applies for the trademark Combiner Force. So maybe that's cool. The third set in this little series or whatever. Me personally, I'm kind of a little done with Combiner, so hopefully that's not the case.
I don't think it'll be the case. I think maybe it would be for, like, you know, because we heard the rumors that there was going to be Combiner War stuff coming out with Titans Returns. So, I mean, it could be that.
Cool. They're going to hit all the Operation Combination stuff. Give us all that type of stuff. Oh, where's that? That glorious thing that...
So we're going to go through these a little bit quicker, because...
Speaking of something where the box art looks much better than the product inside,
yeah. Here we are. And we're seeing the product now.
Look at all these female characters that don't look really at all like female characters. Not saying they have to adhere to a certain standard, but I don't know.
Are you body shaming?
I might be body shaming.
Are you body shaming these women?
Look at this. They don't even have the arms like. They don't have the arms transformed.
They got stubby arms.
Oh my goodness.
Oh wow.
I like the boots though, or the little like shoes, little heel points.
I like the hands. Her points. Her the newly sculpted hands and the sword. I think the sword's nice, but that's like it.
Huh. Yeah, it's weird. Interesting.
Are you laughing at Tuala?
Oh, what do you even say? Check your privilege.
This says it represents a chest. Gosh.
All right.
Oh, my goodness.
All right, what else we got here? All right, so Takara R.I.D. It's for Jaim.
Cool. I won't go so far to RID, though. I mean, the Japanese stuff.
So. You can see them compared to the Hasbro one. So whenever you look at that, I mean, you know, you kind of start to wonder, like, why don't you go with the gray here? Because that brown, it looks like so much better there.
It's just Takara wanting to show up Hasbro.
And if anyone can do it.
I mean, look at that. That looks pretty good, so...
That looks like a brown bulkhead repaint that doesn't turn into bulkhead.
Yeah. Forgot who this character is. Quillfire?
When are they going to wrap up this series and like go to something that's a little bit...
Quillfire, yeah.
Sad that I know that. But we'll go there.
He's in your stack right now.
Yeah, I'm trying to seek help and get some professional counseling, but...
All right, so take a look at the Takara 5-pack. And we've got some comparisons with Hasbro as well.
Wow. What happened to his midsection? It just went away with that pose.
Yeah. Like,
boom, gone. Look, my legs into my chest.
We all know that this mold just suffers.
My thighs come out of my rib cage.
Oh my goodness, that's just bad.
It is, dude. It's such a bad, like, the Combiner Wars, like, Optimus Motormaster is not that great. Yeah. But I'll say this, I mean, like, with everything Takara, the paint apps, you know, I mean, just the overall, like, the paint, the whatever plastics they molded it in, it looks better than the Hasbro.
Yeah.
But it's to be expected.
But this is something that it should have been like discovered by a kid when they're just, oh, I can plug these together, not actually shown so the public can see it and be like,
yeah,
no.
All right, so you got Takara on the right, Hasbro on the left on these. Ironhide, you know, it's not that big of a difference, I don't think. I think they should have done, on both of them, they should have done the chest red.
Yeah, I like how the hands are painted on the Takara one, though. That's something that bugged me on the Hasbro version.
Yeah.
But I like the black, though, on the Hasbro, though. Yeah. For the the chest just hides the combiner port a little bit better.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's got to be difficult to paint that port, though. You know what I mean? Because it'll rub off.
Yeah.
Mold it in red.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. See, I like Mirage being that darker blue, too.
Yep, I also like... See, this is what I'm talking about. Because he's supposed to have the white chest, you did white here. You molded it that color, so...
Yeah.
And you can see they also did some flip-flops on paint here.
Yeah.
And got the line going around. So just, you know, more detail. Then your boy Optimus. You can see the chest being different here, and then also the feet, main thing.
The windshield's a different shade of blue, but it's all minor, I guess.
Yeah, especially when you put an add-on kit on it. Yeah, you will notice.
Yeah. Which is what I can't wait to do with my G2 Minotaur.
And they also painted the rims, which was nice. But still, why you no paint the side here, Takara? Come on. These little windows, why not?
It's probably just an oversight, maybe.
They probably thought, like, well, whatever.
Function Ripper Lamos loves it.
You went, you know, the black in the chest, so it kind of covers that up. You don't see it where you went gray here.
And I like how they painted the little fake headlights on the fake chest or whatever. On the brow. Just little nice touches.
And the breakup in the legs, they flip-flopped them black and silver.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to. Oh, and the hands, they flip-flopped the hands and forearm, too. But quite a bit of difference there.
Wish they would have painted that little... You know, and the Hasbro version has that problem, too. But I wish Takara would have...
Like, what is their deal of why they don't want to paint this?
I don't know if they molded it in some kind of different plastic or something. I'm not sure.
I've heard people, like, on both ends on this one, but I like the Takara one.
Yeah.
All right, let's see what else we got here. All right, also the car, it kind of looks like it's going to be coming with this little extra piece here as well.
That's cool.
The vehicle for the Headmaster. Is that what that is?
It looks like it. You like that idea? Because someone mentioned on Facebook they're like, oh, kind of like a little Action Master.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if the Headmaster can fit in the, you know, in the cockpit.
Right.
I mean, it's a cool little extra thing. I wouldn't see me using it, I guess.
I think it's just there to help justify the price.
Probably.
Yeah. And Skullcruncher.
I'm saying, yeah, it looks like you get one with Skullcruncher, too.
Yeah, it's the same thing we saw with, what, Scourge?
Yeah.
That time. Now, if you can take those little vehicles or whatnot and, like, add them to the base modes to make them bigger, better,
that would be cool.
That would be kind of cool.
Yeah, because it looks like all the Titan Masters can sit in them and pilot them. So that would be neat.
All right, now, with these two guys, I wanted to show this because now we get a closer image of those, you know, Hardhead and Skullcruncher's heads. Pull up here. Alright, so Skullcruncher here, and then this one's Hardhead. So you can see the different faces.
These look good, man. I say it every time we look at the Titans Return stuff, I'm really looking forward to seeing this stuff hit retail.
Hot item right here. Let's go. All right, and looks to be final pictures of Masterpiece Ratchet. Still need to ship my Ironhide to me, but... Jaim, have you got Ironhide in yet?
Yeah, I haven't got Hot Rod, though, yet.
You like Ironhide?
Yeah. I mean, it's I'm surprised, and I think I'm more just happy that we finally have a G1 cartoon Ironhide. Because the original G1, you know, obviously went off the comic book, and because of being the Diclone. So it's not, and having the classics, I mean, this was really nice.
Yeah. What about the molds that they used, like in the Botcon 05 set?
Oh, I love that. That Ratchet and Ironhide are the best.
Yeah, I always thought they were just great.
Yeah.
Well, as far as like the classics, you know, update would go.
Now, James, since you have the Ironhide, because I haven't had mine shipped to me yet, does he have the sleds at the bottom, or does it just land flat like that?
Flat.
Oh, that's unfortunate. Are there any additional weapons here that he comes with that Ironhide doesn't?
Not to my knowledge.
Oh, we saw him come with some wrenches and stuff, so.
Which I'd give to, like, Wheeljack or something. But I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, a little blowtorch.
I like the little hot heart rate monitor thing in his chest, too.
And Ratchet doesn't come with the jetpack, does he? So that's to replace, what, the wrenches? Or, I mean, I guess that's replacing that.
So,
I don't know.
He gets the little flamethrower and the wrenches instead of the jetpack. Okay.
Yeah.
That's a nice trade. Oh, he's so excited about him too, man.
He is.
It's like he just ran down from stairs on Christmas. That's exactly what I wanted. Oh god.
That's actually me in the picture. Josh was the first one that pointed it out. Did you just tag me? Josh was the first one that pointed it out, and I was like, "No, that was my nice little Easter egg to the fandom." For this.
Yeah. This poor gal can't transform Dinobot, though. Poor gal.
This is the Primal Sabbath in a wig.
Oh, dude, I cannot wait for this.
I can.
I think it comes out in June, and that's going to be a very expensive month for me. Because as soon as HLJ puts them up, I'm just like, send me a case.
She's still working on that Dinobot, though.
Yeah, she is. She never did finish it. Poor gal. It's not like it's a hard mold.
You know, with Beast Wars, you have to take a certain level of caution.
You can pop them off, those ball joints will pop back on if you want.
But the trick is to not, you know, that's the chore.
All right, so we kind of knew this was coming. I believe they're calling it Delta Magnus. It's going to be, I believe, $190. And is it August that it's coming?
Yeah. I think. Yeah. Same price as Ultra
Magnus. Now, is that going to be cheaper? Is that going to be, okay, so it's the same price as Magnus?
Yeah.
Cool.
So, it's not bad.
I mean, I think we all kind of saw this coming, so.
I'm still keeping my KFC die stack, though. Just for kicks.
Now we just need a shining pea yellow Magnus.
Pea yellow Magnus.
Yeah.
They should correct it and change it to blue instead of yellow, but whatever. Because they messed up on that, but whatever. It's all good.
So, everybody getting this one?
I might.
Oh, it's going to be a hard pass.
What? Jaim.
Well, I have the die stack, and I like that one because it's bigger than Ultra Magnus, and I have the faceplate on it, too. This one won't have the faceplate. It's going to be the same size as Ultra Magnus. But if I have $190 just burning a hole in my wallet, maybe I might pick it up. I don't know.
You know, if I had started on the Diclone masterpieces that Takara, you know, that they were putting out, I think I would get it. Because I think that's neat. The Diclone masterpiece thing. I just don't want to go and backtrack all of them now.
Jaim, you got to quit blowing your money on them KOs, man. All right, so getting into the KOs now.
Into the KOs. Oh, my goodness.
The Oscular Max. You know what? I had no idea that there's three of these things. So the Make Toys, Oscular Max, and the X-Transbot. So three companies doing Inferno.
Yep.
What's that tell you? Expect a car pretty soon.
He's a popular character.
Everybody's just been jonesing for Inferno.
Damn, it's about time. Where is that guy? We got Red Alert. We need that Inferno. There they are. Totally different sizes, but good to go. And I think this one actually has a way, I think it says like Portland Fire Department or something on the side, which I thought was pretty cool.
Oh, that's neat, yeah.
It's close to Pacific Northwest, close to home. Aw. Derpy to a little bit less derpy. Sorry, but that's not a really good face sculpt. I'm sorry. Dr. Wu, I'm going to need something on that. But I guess the character in the G1 cartoon is a little...
Well, yeah, he changes a couple times.
See, I really want anyone who's doing the grapple to make him kind of crazy, to have him have that effect. Go that way with my crooked...
And, of course.
Yep, there it is. That's the test. Yeah. I'm sold.
I mean, that's why they all do it now. It's like, they're like, show Jaim the one kick.
I need the super kick. If you can do the super kick, you know Victory Saber 77 is going to buy it.
All right, so this is not the same one. This is X-Transbots now.
Next to Bathing Ape, though, I'll take that. As I noticed, that's the only thing I noticed. But it's the knockoff. That's big. First vehicle mode.
So,
but yeah, he's huge next to MP10.
Yeah, that one's a little bit taller than the rest of them.
Make toys so far. I think it's the winner.
All right, fans project. Hi, bro. Whatever his fake name.
What's his fake name?
I don't know. Looks good, but I have a feeling that a $17 counterpart's going to come out soon. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, probably. I'm done with Fans Project, though. I'm just,
Dude, just the weight, everything about it is just, you know what? I mean, I still think it looks good, but I ended up selling, someone ended up finally buying my lot of Fans Project Headmasters, so.
I have a feeling they tried to pose it straight up and down, but that knee buckled just a tad bit because of the QC. That's why it's bent.
But that's just right here?
Yeah, no, the other one. I don't think they bent it. I think it did it on its own. I just hate the fact that their joints are so loose, and they just, I don't know. They don't know what to do with it. Soft ratchets, all that. Yeah. Oh, well, go back to add-on kits.
Yeah, dude, seriously. Like, they haven't made a good add-on kit in a while.
Go the perfect effect route. Start doing some add-on kits.
Now, here's this thing from
Speaking Fans of Project. That. There's your add-on kit. Isn't that an add-on kit?
Yeah.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. Like, some of it looked like it should have, some of it didn't.
Back to the classics mold, though. See it going back there.
I'm really a big fan of this one right here.
Yeah, I think they lost their touch for add-on kits.
Add-on kits on current molds. Let's go that route.
Granted, like, if I'm not mistaken, like, this doesn't parts form. Like, this adds two, and, you know, you don't have to parts form. And that's cool and everything. I don't want to take away from that. But, yeah.
Give me parts forming and make it look awesome. Yeah.
Or go back to the Wreckers. Do the Warbot series, Fans Project. Do that. And then I would probably end up needing to buy your stuff.
Yeah. Right, this is, I believe, Spark Toys. Yeah.
That looks good.
That looks really good.
This is MP scaled, right?
Yeah, this is
the big one. I lost interest.
But they're coming out with, what, a Grimlock, Megatron?
I just don't see why War Within has to be MP scaled.
They want to make it awesome for you, Dakota.
Yeah, I'm sure there's people out there that say the same thing about, why is Beast Wars going with MP scale?
Yeah.
About this.
See, but Beast Wars deserves it. Like, not saying War Within was bad, because I like the designs. I'm just saying, like, I don't know, dude. I miss the classic scales. Like, I miss that so much with third party.
Yeah.
It's, I don't know.
This is going to be great for a Prime shelf. Or any, you know, anyone out there that's collecting Prime. Definitely I'd have that on there.
Here it is in Robot.
Because it is impressive.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I don't want to say it's not. Like, I don't want to try to take that away from it. I just, I don't know. Like, are you going to have this thing front and center, or are you going to have MP10 front and center? You know?
True. Oh, he's got a Matrix. I'd take an MP scale Galaxy Convoy.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Maybe more than this, but... Now, this is all die-cast, like the original Titanium series. Now, that would be impressive.
That would...
destroy your shelf and everything below it.
Your book, like a bookcase just comes tumbling forward as soon as you set them on it.
50 pounds.
Put them on one end of the shelf. You have to have all five Fans, Toys, Dinobots on the other one to counterbalance it.
There you go. Need some extra weight in the back of my pickup. I'll just put in my War Within Optimus back there. But yeah, that looks good. I don't think it's too expensive either. This would be an impulse buy if I happen to see it at a convention. I'd be like, maybe.
See what else we got. And Omnigonics, okay.
Oh, spin out.
Yeah. So maybe it's closer to its date. People that have had it on pre-order for 2 years are getting excited.
Or wondering, where is this charge coming from?
What? Why is my bank calling me? I don't even have that credit card anymore. Well, it's in scale the way you want it, and I still think it looks, you know, good. So.
Yeah, I've heard mixed reviews about Bad Cube, so this might get some love.
Your boy Planet X.
Now this is nice. I think we didn't look at this a couple of weeks ago, or am I just thinking of like when I saw it online?
That was the Prime one.
Okay, yeah, dude, the Starscream looks great. I don't know if I'd get it. I mean, I probably might, just because it's Starscream. Because I mean, man, I'm really liking what they did with this.
This is Planet X being the same into the same scale as their Dinobots and all that, right?
Yeah. I mean, this would more than likely be Voyager scale.
That's cool.
I mean, I do like the little Generations Deluxe that came out, but this, I think, would scratch the itch a little bit better.
Would this get you to get their Dinobots?
If they release the Dinobots in, you know, a gift set... Yep, I will buy them. I will buy them in a gift set, like especially if there's a foam insert. Like that's an automatic. The foam insert makes it a 100%, but if they release it in like a box set, that like it's still like a 90% that I'll pick it up.
It makes me miss that game. I wish that was a game that they would port over to PS4 and Xbox One. Make it cheap.
It was fun playing it, but they're not going to make it cheap.
And it had no audience because people were playing multiplayer like a few months in.
Yeah.
All right, DX9 for your little bitty dudes, warm pocket.
Well, that's cool.
He can be a little war in your pocket if you wanted him to.
A cup for you. Take it however you want.
There you go.
That looks good. Looks good with the blur. Don't really care for that Rodimus.
Rodimus in there. I don't know about that.
And there's their little Hulky.
Nice. Cup's pulling a wheelie.
That looks good. I mean, all that DX9 warm pocket stuff looks really good.
Yeah, it does. That and Iron Factory.
I can't wait to get their Drift and Deadlock. I think that'll be my first purchase from them.
All right, so Keys Fantasy Club is going to do a cassette. They're going to come out with this and an all-black version.
Oh, going back to the roots.
All black, huh?
So is that probably...
Slugfest?
I will admit, Keith's Fantasy is at least they're doing something with that whole cassette realm where no one else is doing anything with it. They're giving us a ton of characters. I mean, we got Rosanna. I mean, really? And all this. I think we need flip size and give us maybe the white frenzy and all this other stuff too. That'd be great.
And then we got Beatbox and Bird Bomber from them too, didn't we?
Yeah.
Well, talk.
Squawk Talk and even, I think, Grand Slam.
All right. This is Fans Want It. Add-on kit. You know why you're getting it?
Because fans want it.
Exactly.
That's something else I can appreciate, is fans want it, strictly tackling the movie stuff. I don't think anyone else tackles movie stuff.
Yeah. I have their Ironhide cannons for the leader class. Those are sweet.
Nice.
And not only do you get the sword, gun, shield, you also get the jetpack.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
Wow.
You know why?
Because fans want it.
Absolutely. It never gets old.
I feel like every time he's just specifically setting me up, and I just don't want to disappoint.
Don't disappoint me, Dakota. You have her son to think about.
Too Lala, we're thinking about you. You're my boy.
It's pretty cool to have all that stuff, but if you already have the DX9 or whatever that Jinrai add-on kit.
Right.
But it's nice to have. Oh, this is nice.
All right, getting into the non-Transformer stuff. This is the Voltron that I've been waiting on. The ultimate... EX version.
And you lost Dakota because
what?
Oh, Dakota just screw this, I'm out.
But this one is $400. It's going to be coming, I believe it said third quarter.
Yeah.
Jaim, are you interested enough to get this?
Oh, yeah, I'd buy that.
I sold my Masterpiece one so that I could buy this one.
Which one is this one? I'm sorry, my computer just kicked me.
We looked at this at San Diego Comic-Con last year, and we saw this, and this is the one that I looked at, and I was like, oh, I'm selling my Masterpiece, so I can buy this. And we didn't have an idea on price. Well, it's going to be $400.
Oh, wow. Is it
it's
big?
Huge. It's huge.
Can the little army men pilot it? little space men's.
Oh, look at that. Oh, kitty.
Articulation.
Kachiko.
And we just totally lost it. I do like the fact that the lions are to scale a little bit better than other renditions of Voltron, so that's cool.
Yeah. I can already tell by looking at this that I like it better than the Masterpiece one. I'm glad I sold that.
$400 though?
Hey, man, you want the ultimate version? The end-all, be-all version? Then there you go.
So Takara's going to come out with the ultimate line, like, almost whenever Masterpiece is done.
It looks really good. I like it.
It's going to be a big box.
Oh, yeah. I forget it. Isn't it? It's over 2 feet, right?
That? Yeah, I think it rivals the Maddie one. Or close to it.
Let's just hope it can, like, it's more stable than the Maddie one.
Oh, well, of course, because it's the ultimate version, Dakota. Did you not read that?
I'm sorry. Apparently I'm illiterate. Forgive me.
All right. So Star Wars Black Series, 6-inch Black Series. This is going to be your new Kmart exclusive, just like the Kylo Ren Starkiller base. You're going to have the Rey Starkiller base. So, and you finally get Rey with this lightsaber.
Oh, that's cool. And you get little diorama pieces, too. That's neato.
Yeah. Yay. Now I get my third Rey in the same freaking outfit. The only difference is now you're giving her a lightsaber.
Yeah, but the Disney store came out with one, didn't they? With the lightsaber?
Yeah, but that's for the Elite. That's the die-cast one.
And that's just a tad bit bigger, isn't it, in scale?
It's a little bit bigger. Let me get it real quick. It's a little bit bigger. But I've already pre-ordered this. Actually, I pre-ordered two.
Just so cool.
Shipping and then sell the other one. So.
It looks good.
Got to keep the line complete. All right, this is Boss Fight Studio. They did a Kickstarter, but if you're interested in these, you can find them over at bossfightshop.com if you're interested in them. So they're due out in April. They said they have 195 pictures. We're not looking at 195.
Oh, gosh.
We'll look at a couple of highlights here.
How many pictures could you take of a Spartan? You know what I mean?
Well, there's
Oh, okay. There's like more stuff. All right.
We looked at these a year and a half ago, I think. And so they're just now coming through with them. And they had all these different characters. I think it was a San Diego Comic-Con, like, 2 years ago.
Was that thing we were all, like, curious about, like, how all these fantastically sculpted figures were, and we didn't know who or what? Was that them?
Yeah, it might have been. These are 1/18 scale.
Oh, they're big.
Well, I mean, 1/18, that'd be smaller than 6 inches, right?
Is that what is this, 3 3/4 inch? Yeah, because 6 inches is hot toys.
Yeah, well, yeah.
1/4, 1/8. Yeah, it's hot toys. Okay, yeah. Yeah, you're looking at smaller.
Yeah, because 6 inch would basically be like 1/12. But they have where you can take all the little pieces off and change them out and do all the. Basically, like Glios.
Play with this too?
Yeah, kind of like that.
They look good for 3 3/4 inch.
Yeah, no kidding. You got a whole lot of detail in all that.
Yeah, here's all the pictures that they had, so I'm not going to cover those. So. All right, Matty Collector said that they're going to redo Pumra per our request, original version this way, and here is the revised version. So kind of shorten the neck, made the cheeks a little bit wider, not so narrow in the chin. Also messed with the hair some as well. You like the changes?
Yeah, I mean, it's different once you see actual paint on it. Sure.
I would have been happy with
with either, but yeah, I think that looks a little bit better, so that's fine.
It's not like it's
narrow in the face.
It's not like the Lionel, or the Lino that they did. Like the first one we saw, I'm like, okay, it's cool, we're behind it, but then they redid it, and we're like, oh, that's even much better. Oh, this one, I don't have that kind of like, oh yeah, it's so much better now. I don't know. Whatever.
All right, and this is from Mafex Figures. Let's see, what was it? They're going to be about 6 inches, but the Captain Phasma is going to be 6.7, and they're going to run anywhere from, let's see, color in, it says 52, Captain Phasma 61, and then it says C-3PO and BB-8 will be 87. They will be packaged together.
Yeah. This is in between the Black Series and Figure Arts. As far as prices, but same size scale.
Yeah, so I basically pre-order. I've already got this color in on pre-order.
Yeah, he looks the best with the mask off.
And then his cape on the outside is cloth too. So
yeah,
that's something else that I like that I didn't like on the Figure Arts one.
Yeah, I like their Darth Vader better than the Figure Arts.
Now, Dakota, are you going to get your girl?
Cloth cape? I think I'm going to pass.
What?
She's got a nice shine, too.
Yeah.
Don't say anything.
She really buffed it out.
Be cool if she had a removable helmet.
Yeah.
That'd be a first. I still don't understand why she's like so popular. Like you hardly see any of the like her out there, like as far as the Black Series or even the Figure Arts.
It's the chrome. It's the
yellow chrome. Yeah. Now this color ran, dude, that looks so much better. That looks awesome. With that cloth cape and everything and that sword. Or the, you know, the lightsaber.
Yeah. You can take a Black Series Kylo Ren and take all that stuff off and put it on the Figure Arts to make it better, but yeah, this one's nice right out of the package.
And then, yeah, you can do it unmasked.
Yeah, that
there
looks
you good. Go, Dakota. That's what you wanted, right?
He also sings along Jonas Brothers songs. It's got a little lights and sounds feature.
That's fine.
I'm Matt. I'm a radar technician. That if they came with an alternate body with that on there, oh my goodness.
I want a 6-inch radar technician mat.
That would be great.
You know what? Maybe you need to pre-order 2 of these because I can do 1 mask and 1 unmask. But like you get a little mashed up Darth Vader helmet.
Yeah. The look of I'm about to throw my lightsaber. I'm about to chuck this at you.
Mr. Kylo, we have bad news.
Where's that computer console?
Those look really good. I like those. I might reorder all of them. Alright, the Playarts Kai, Wonder Woman. I think she looks really good, too.
Yeah, I'm sold. I'll buy that one.
Okay, I was going to ask if you were going to get it because I know you do the kind of the
Playarts guy stuff, yeah.
Or what is it, the weird-looking ones? Or the variant?
The weird ones.
I'm right. Sorry, I'm sorry. I was trying to think of the right word, and then it came to me after I said weird
ones. The DC variants.
You know, the strange stuff. But, yeah, this looks really good.
Yeah, it looks really, really good. Don't know if I'm going to buy, like, Superman. Maybe I'll buy the Batman. But yeah, definitely her. I mean,
well, you gotta, you get her, get her boyfriend too.
Get her boyfriend.
Her man crush. Dude, she loves Batman. All my knowledge is based off of Bruce Timm's Justice League stuff. Hal Jordan. I don't even know who that is. Dude, I thought about John Stewart.
He had one slight cameo in the Justice League. Yeah, I like the fact she comes with a sword and a shield. I mean, the variant She didn't even come with any of that. Oh, she came with a shield. Yeah, I know. Look at that. That's nice. The lasso is removable. The variant doesn't have that option.
And that, you know, your basic stand and stuff.
Yeah.
All right, I got one in here for Dakota. But it's not this one.
No, so he goes back.
Mute yourself. Go back to your hole.
Go back to your hole. Get back in your cage.
You're not up yet.
Dude, I was getting so excited. I was like, one for me? And then I see Batman. I'm like, oh, one for Josh.
Now, you're going to do armored Batman or the unarmored?
I was thinking I'd probably get both, actually. I like the unarmored because it reminds me of the Dark Knight.
Right.
And the armor's not too bad.
Yeah, I don't think they overdid it on the armor. I think it's just right.
Yeah.
Got his little neutered bat ears, but hey.
Scrapes and stuff looks nice.
Yep. Looking forward to it.
I don't like Batman having a gun now.
Well, then you wouldn't like the variants, because he comes with big old guns, but they're, you know, grapple guns, but still.
Yeah.
You need something to take on Superman. Batarang's just not going to do it.
There you go, Dakota.
Oh, this was what was for me?
I didn't know Dakota was an Ant-Man fan.
I like the movie, but I don't have a plan on getting the toys. So one for Josh, one for nobody. Awesome.
this is figure arts too. Well,
yeah,
it looks good. Like I can't, you know. It's something I'm not gonna buy. I think it looks great.
How many versions do we get of him?
There. Well, he actually. Shrinks, Dakota.
Mm.
Boom! That's the same guy right there.
But what kind of witchcraft is Play Arts Kai selling us?
So.
Comes with any ants.
Yeah, he also comes with this little coffee thing here too. So.
Should come with some sugar cubes. Has ants going around. The only thing I don't like about the Marvel figure art stuff is the price point on them. I think they're way overpriced. Around like $130 to $140.
They're proud of it.
Yeah.
So for the SH figure arts, the 50th anniversary Ultraman figures, you're going to be able to get Ultraman by himself. You can get him and some buildings, and then you can buy some buildings all by themselves, destructed or together. So.
I got some of those for my monster arts for Godzilla and all that.
I remember seeing a little bit of Ultraman when I was young, but I don't remember a whole lot from it.
I just like the carbon copy from Godzilla Jet Jaguar. That's what I like.
Little buildings are neat.
Yeah, get some of those little buildings and stuff.
I like how companies are starting to do this like diorama-friendly stuff. Like I dig that. The figure arts, I mean, they've been doing it with like some of the DBZ stuff.
Yeah, and the monster arts.
Yeah. So this is cool.
Cool if you had like Attack on Titan type figures.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. What does that say, Tula saying? Being small in certain places. What? Oh, I was just reading some of the Chihuahua's comments to Dakota.
Yeah,
Right. Oh, Dalton, you're not going to be soft hands anymore. Oh.
Yeah, he is.
He's got to teach the trade. He needs an apprentice, and I think that's going to be Barrett.
All right, the Gokin Shredder.
That looks cool. Like, the sculpt looks great.
Same ones doing the, they did the Krang. So. I'm hoping that we get, when we see San Diego Comic-Con this year, that they, you know, because of the, you know, new Turtle movie coming out, that they're like, all right, you're finally getting those classics, Krang and Shredder. If not, I may have to just go this route because then it'll probably never happen.
Yeah.
Is that where you're going to draw the line, Jaim?
Yeah, essentially. I mean, there's they need to make them. I mean, I was hoping NECA would have finished it off, but they never did anything. And then the classics came around. I'm saying, okay, cool. We saw those picks, but yeah, it's disappointing not to get like a Shredder in that size or a really cool looking one, posable one. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. All right, and 112, they're going to be doing the captain's chair. And so they said, hey, look, you can put the disc down here. And you got some little buttons and stuff like that. Looks like some light-up features. So if you're a Star Trek fan, pretty cool.
That's neat.
And little pieces and stuff.
Charge extra for having Oh... You guys are going to have a good time.
All right, and the QMX, Malcolm.
He's going to be at Emerald City Con.
Get this figure and have him sign it?
No, I wouldn't go that far.
Like, excuse me.
I am getting the gal that voices Ahsoka, though.
Oh, man.
Some stuff. Snips.
I love Snips. I like her in Rebels, too.
Yeah. Oh, we're going to talk about that. Hopefully you're up to date with your Rebels.
Oh. Is it the Jedi Temple thing?
Yep.
Okay, yeah.
Shroud, or whatever it's called. Yep. It's not all going to be about Beast Wars on tonight's show. Don't worry.
All right, so that means I can just dip out after Beast Wars and we're good.
Sure. Yeah. But real quickly, the show's going to be running a little late, so for any of you out there.
All right, Hot Toys, they have this display. I'm going as quick as I can.
No, no, don't worry about it. No, I don't care. I still need a break between this and the other show. I mean.
Oh, yeah. All right. But they have this set up in a mall in Hong Kong. It's not like the actual thing. Like you could drive this. It's just put together. Hot Toys did where it's a 1:1 scale. Where they did the Batmobile, they did Batman and the other characters, and showing off with some of their other Hot Toys stuff. So, and this is going to be rotating as well. Yeah, different places.
That's cool. I remember seeing the Tumblr.
Yeah.
Vancouver, I think. That was impressive. But, whoa.
Yeah.
I thought that was a real person for a second.
Yeah, get the...
Like what?
1:1 scale Hot Toys Wonder Woman?
Weird.
All right. Well, we're going to get into something here in a second.
Oh, we getting that Harley? Oh. But, yeah.
I get the Wonder Woman.
So if that's a functioning, oh man, that would be a cool bat signal.
Yeah, and they said that's a 1:1 scale too, so all of that is.
I live out in the country. I'd spotlight that up in there. Oh wait, my wife's calling me. I need to go. I'm Batman. It's a cool diorama. Foam. Some imagination, some tape, and
yeah,
paint, and you're good to go. Those are cool.
Some of the larger, the Cos babies. And if you look in here, that's the 1/6 scale Batmobile that they have for Hot Toys that you can go buy. So imagine how big all this is.
Wow. Was that to get the picture taken?
Yeah.
With Wonder Woman?
Yeah.
Look at my girlfriend. All right, cool.
The Batmobile line's like way over there. It's like no weight. But here's the 1/6 scale. Tell me, do you bleed? I do like the Batmobile in this movie. I think it looks cool.
You gonna pick it up?
I just need to pick up the Tim Burton Batmobile.
You going the Hot Toys route? Are you gonna pick up any of this stuff?
I don't know. I want to see the movie first. Oh, look at him, man! He's in his little bat wing.
And the scruff he's got.
Yeah, I don't like the scruff. He should have shaved. The Cos Babies.
Oh, I like that one. The Joker. That was cool.
And some plush stuff for Dakota.
I appreciate all the plush stuff they do for me.
Some pillows. Alright, let's see what we got here. Alright, Cosmic Babies, what we were just kind of looking at, but you're going to have these different chrome versions, and you can see that they're going to have light-up features as well. I'm going to go kind of quick on these. Oh, look at the little Wonder Woman, how happy she is.
Everybody else is all angry and frowning. Yeah,
dude, and Aquaman is just pissed off.
Yeah. She's just happy. She's bringing the Trinity together.
Is she with you? I thought she was with you.
This remind me of that episode of Justice League Unlimited where they shrink down to a kid, the whole Mordred episode. Oh, this reminds me of those. It's funny. Aquaman. She's actually with me.
And then he's a sad Batman.
No one likes me. Money can't buy me friends.
He got a little bit of articulation to him, too, which is kind of cool. All right, I know it's going to be Hot Toys something. What is it? Oh, the Armored Batman. Black chrome version. That looks sweet. And it's got the light up eyes, too. I don't know if I like the whole... That's fine, but with him all showing his teeth, it looks like he's ready to go to the dentist. You know, he's, you know, a little too much teeth. Don't do it, Dakota.
I wanted to. I refrained. And the only reason I refrained is because my mic was muted. And I said it, and I was like, crap.
All right, so all the stuff you're going to get, you know, all the different hands, the stand, the, you know, teething and
teething.
Teeth, and then you're at the little accessories here. All right, and for you guys that were collecting the Hot Toys Guardians of the Galaxy, now you're finally going to get Drax.
Oh, cool, you get the whole team now. You get Batista.
Now, you guys that like Guardians of the Galaxy, you think it looks good? You happy?
What if they just had a head, like a random head in there that was like John Cena?
John Cena? Yeah, that would be great. John Cena, Randy Orton, or something in there.
Now, Dakota, are you going to get the Hot Toys little rocket? You see them right there, right?
Dude, I want to. I just don't know where I'd put it. Because, like, that's the best rocket for your, you know, for your dollar, I think. All the ones that Hasbro came out with were, like, unarticulated or too small or whatever. But the Hot Toys is like, right on the money, I think.
Put them next to Deadpool. Get the Hot Toys Deadpool, and you can...
Yeah.
Yeah, I could.
Next to each other.
Dude, whenever I went and bought my Barbie-style Batgirl or whatever it was, dude, you know what shelf I put her on? Right up there with the $200 Hot Toys, man.
It's not like... I mean, it's more or less like I'm looking at stuff that I have, like, space on the shelf for, and I'm like, well, I don't think Hot Toys Rocket Raccoon would go great next to Megazarek, Sentinel Maximus, and Cryotech. You know what I mean?
There with the figure art stuff.
Throw them there with your Halo.
About that, I was going to say, like, there is no more figure art stuff. I could probably put it in with, like, the Halo and Assassin's Creed stuff. Why not? There's a Ghost Rider in there randomly.
And the stuff you get, so those hands, daggers, Stan.
Hmm. Cool.
All right, and two things left. All right, Star Wars R5-J2, more pictures of him now.
Are you picking this up?
I'm kind of going with must-buys at the moment, and this isn't a must. I want to get those out of the way.
You feel it's going to be difficult playing catch-up, in a way, if there's anything that was previously released?
Yeah.
Give me some Hot Toys Jawas. With some droid parts. There we go. That's what I'd want.
I mean, I love the R2-D2, though. That thing is awesome. But this doesn't look like it has as much cool stuff, though.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, I gotta get Vader next, and then I want some TIE fighters. And I think that was it. That is, yeah, $140.
So. To all I asked, where my Hot Toy Slavely at?
All right, so here's something. This is To all I's next pre-order, but NECA is doing a Batman Arkham City life-size foam Harley Quinn. On here, they say, this foam statue is a great companion piece.
Yeah, well, it's a to their life-size Arkham, right? 5'11".
I know that. She's tall.
Yeah. That gal standing next to her is short. Wow.
So.
She posable? Is that all she can do?
Wow.
I mean, I'm not saying it. Don't take that in a weird way. I'm just saying that she's got, like, a gun behind her, and she just, I don't know.
It'd be in foam, I would think not, but...
Yeah.
But does she have working foam?
Interesting.
I don't know.
But what's this thing going to run? $1,000?
Probably, I looked on the NECA website and it didn't have it listed.
More if she does indeed have working parts.
So.
That's funny.
I just know there's going to be some fans out there that.
Yep.
One question, I guess, and then we will jump off. This is from Jonathan McKnight. He says, question for the Cybercast. Do you think the reason for so few female Transformers is due to a stigma that boys don't buy female action figures? Did a character being a woman ever influence you whether or not you would buy it as a kid?
That's a good question.
Yeah. So
I think it was that way, like, in the 80s and even in the 90s to a certain point. But now I don't think that's the case at all. I mean, you know, if we're talking specifically Transformers, I mean, we've definitely seen an increase in female characters just in, the last 5 years.
Yeah. Well, you even saw it in Beast Wars, too, where you're getting more female characters.
Yeah, which, I mean, in the show, definitely, but, you know, you look at Black Arachne and Airazor as toys, and they were, you know, but they were basically gender neutral. Black Arachne being a straight-up Tarantulas repaint, and Airazor, you know, didn't look anything like she did in the show. Until we got, like, Transmetal 2 Black Arachne. then bras were coming off. So, you know, but, I mean, and you're right, and it's even into the Unicron trilogy with whatever mold they used for that Botcon Alita 1. I can't think of it. Yeah. It was, like, boat that just had, like, the...
I forgot what she was.
Yeah, I can't remember her name either.
Title, I don't know what she was, yeah.
Yeah, I just know she was a boat.
Yep.
And you know, and like I said, I mean, you continue to see it more, and it's, you know, they went, you know, and it's, you know, it started in Beast Wars. They went from being, like, the girly damsel in distress role that, you know, RC played in, you know, G1 cartoon to, okay, these are, you know, strong female roles that, you know, they can handle themselves, type of stuff.
Yeah, you saw that a lot with Black Arachne.
Yeah, and even to a degree with Airazor. I mean, her and Tigatron were often inseparable, but she was still able to, you know, do everything she needed to do. I don't think Airazor ever played damsel in distress, and you know, you got that a lot with Prime RC. I think that's probably the strongest female character that we've seen in Transformers.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, what do you think, Jaim?
As far as me, yeah, I mean, like, 80s, you wanted to buy, you know, the boys stuff and all that, and you're influenced by that. But for me, I still went, like, if it was a main character, let's say, going to Mask, I would want to buy Manta with Vanessa Warfield, because she was a main staple in that show. And but if you go into G.I. Joe, was I going out trying to get a Lady J or a Scarlet or a Cover Girl or a Baroness? No, I wasn't really trying to do that, or like a Teela from Masters of the Universe. But, you know, I don't know. It just depends on what I'd want. But, like, nowadays, yeah, I mean, definitely. I don't really need to always have to have these, like we just saw that Harley. It's, you know, seductive, all that type of stuff. You know, it's like, I just want to be true to the character of the comic books or to the game, whatever the source material is. I like those characters, like Harley, Wonder Woman, you know. I think we've come a long ways, and we're seeing that more introduced. I mean, you look at the new Batman Superman wave. You got the elite version and the basic of Wonder Woman in there, even though she doesn't look really good, but it's in there, and it's in the, you know, the guys section, you know, the boys, you know, action figures. You got the same thing with, like, Ray. So I don't know, it works.
Yeah, I think it, with the 80s is where it kind of started. And that's when we were kids and grew up, so, or at least Jaim and I. But to where that's whenever they started the whole cartoons, you know, mixing with toys and stuff like that. So, you know, some companies, they may not knew how to handle it. Like, let's say, Transformers, you know, RC not being introduced until the 86 animated movie. So Transformers already been going on for 2 years. But like Jaim said, Mask, G.I. Joe, they were already implemented. He-Man, you had Evil-Lyn. I remember having Evil-Lyn and Teela when I was younger. A lot of kids, you know, Count Marzo that comes on all the time with She-Ra. Dude, he's bragging all the time. Dude, I'm all up in the girls' aisles buying Jim and the Holograms, Misfits. You know, She-Ra, you know, and stuff, because you got the evil horde with She-Ra, so that made, you know, guys, you know, boys want to watch that. Then you even go up to now, it's obviously, you know, it's whatever. If you have a cool character, then you want it, like Jaim said.
Yeah, Laura Croft, look at Laura Croft, Tomb Raider.
Yeah, I mean, I can go with just, you know, I believe this week, you know, I bought a two toys that are, they were intended for girls. They DC superhero girls. But it was Batgirl, and I love Batgirl, so I bought it. Spider-Gwen, my first Marvel Legends figure ever, a female character, Spider-Gwen. You know, Laura Croft, I have the first one from Play Arts, and I have the other one on pre-order that comes out in April. I'm looking forward to that thing. I love that character. So, you know, I think now it's like, hey, as long as they're cool, then you like them. Like, Ahsoka's one of my favorite characters in all of Star Wars, you know?
Yeah.
I can't wait to have that, you know, 6-inch Black Line series figure of her.
That's going to be a hard one to get to find.
I got it on pre-order. Man, I just had to order those cases. Just 2 cases. So, but we will end it there. I have more questions for, you know, Star Wars stuff that I messaged you guys, like, I don't know, like a month and a half ago, but I was still saving them. So we got those, and we'll save those for next week. Anyways, Dakota, tell people where they can find you, man. Plug yourself.
You can find me everywhere at PrimalSabbath, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, so on and so forth.
All right, and Jaim, and you got the shows and Collection Spotlight.
Yeah, we have another show, Plastic Fanatics, the Late Night Aftercast. It's a new name, but it's same show, you know, same host, same guys, and all that type of stuff. But we do have that. 10:30 is usually the starting time, but today, running a little late, probably... what is it, 9 o'clock my time? Let's see, what is that, 11?
Yeah,
a little bit after 11, maybe we'll start it. So that's Central Standard Time. We'll start the broadcast. So I will have the live link on my Facebook page. You can see it underneath my name right there. If you want to join, feel free to. It's open to everyone. Just make sure you have a Google Plus account and all that type of stuff. And make sure that we can communicate. You have like a mic or something. You don't necessarily have to have a camera, but... but we're going to be talking about Beast Wars and other things, so check that out. We do have the Collection Spotlight. If you guys want your collection spotlighted, send your picks to Josh at g1hexron@gmail.com. 10 to 20 picks, unless it's very large, then you could go 21. But it doesn't have to be necessarily all Transformers. We like to, you know, see, you know, Star Wars, Player Sky, anything. We'll showcase you, and we'll get you on. So you can find me, VictorySaber77, Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook. Right there below my name, the Victory Saber 77. All right,
and you can find me, G1Xtron, everywhere. Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, all those places, and my Facebook page is the G1Xtron. So thanks a lot for watching, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed, and we will see you on the
Plastic Fanatics.
Plastic Fanatics. Okay, new name. Sorry.
Yeah.
All right. So peace.